routine hour. And as is typical, we will commence with a roll call.
Ms. Austin?
Here.
Mr. Murphy?
Here.
Ms. Lloyd?
Present.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
Mr. Ailes?
Here.
And Mr. Fraley?
Here, and it does appear that we do have a quorum, and let me commence by saying Happy New Year to everyone. Thanks to everyone for being here. We do have a full quorum, which is a good way to start off our new year. And again, let me wish everyone a very happy, prosperous new year. We'll get right into our agenda. We'll start with the election of the chair for 2022. And I'd like to commence by putting the name of Matt Hales as a candidate for the chairman of the CPC.
And I would like to nominate Kevin Murphy, Mr. Chair.
Oh, did we lose the girl? I think he's buffering. Well, while we hope to get the chairman back, just a reminder to everybody to please, unless you're actually speaking, please mute your microphone.
Thank you, George. Again, we are voting on the chairman, name of Mr. Hales. I vote aye.
Oh, Mr. Fraley, I nominated Mr. Murphy while you were buffering.
Oh, I heard you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, good.
I heard you.
Okay.
Yes. Any other votes for Mr. Hales?
Can I jump in really quickly, Mr. Fraley? I'd like to maybe hear from both Mr. Hales and Mr. Murphy about maybe their ideas and just, I guess, ideas as being chairperson going forward.
Thank you for that, Kim. That's unique, but not inappropriate. Mr. Hale, would you like to speak to that?
Yes, great. Thank you. Well, I appreciate you throwing my name into that for doing that. As most of you guys know, I've been on the Planning Commission for just over 9 years. This will be my last term, so I've got two more years left in this term here. So it certainly will be nice to close out as the chairperson, at least for this year anyways. You got to follow Earl's footsteps in doing this. You know, Earl is, you know, I've been under Earl now for 9 years, and watching how he's run meetings and watching, you know, how he's prepared for meetings, made sure that, you know, I think he must. It's kind of funny, you know, no matter what, I have a few words to say about Earl when we're done voting, but it's always amazed me how Earl has been familiar with every community in our city, every block of our city. He clearly does his homework before every meeting to make sure that he understands what's going on, especially in light of recent, when we can't get out there and do our field trips out there. Some of the folks that hadn't done the field trips yet. And I suspect Earl's been riding around doing field trips on his own prior to the meetings, you know, which I do some of those, but I would plan to make sure I do all of them as many as I can as part of that role. You know, the other thing I'm big on is that, as you guys know, I've watched me run a couple of meetings. I do, you know, George laughs at me that I do run a tight meeting, in that, you know, I try to make sure that everything stays in line which has been specifically difficult during the remote dial end of that. But I'm all about making sure everyone has a fair chance to speak, but also respectful of the commission's time and more importantly, the people in the audience's time. You know, those that are attending other items, you know, you always feel bad for the person that's last on the agenda on a 5-hour meeting. So, you know, we try to run we'd like to, and we'll continue to try to run a fairly tight meeting to be respectful of those that have been there to talk. And again, especially if there's the end of the agenda. So really wasn't prepared to talk like this, but there are some of my immediate thoughts off the top of my head.
Thank you for that, Matt. Kevin, your thoughts, sir?
Well, my first thought is that Matt would make an excellent chair.
You know, he's proven it as serving as vice chair. He's run meetings in Earl's absence. I have no doubt that he would be a great chair. It's just a matter of whether or not the commission thinks that I might be the better person or the right person for the job at this particular time. I've served on Planning Commission for 5-ish years. I've served on ARB for about 4 years. I've been in the position of being an applicant going through ARB and through Planning Commission, so I've seen both sides of it. I was a Civic League president for downtown Norfolk for 10 years, and we have more conditional use applications come through downtown than you know, any other part of the city. So I'm very familiar with the process. I'm familiar with the applicants go through. I am committed to making Norfolk the greatest, best version of itself by celebrating its strengths, its diversity, its connectivity, its proximity to the water. I think that I've demonstrated that as we've reviewed applications as a group. I am respectful of the applicant's time and my fellow commissioners, and I think that I can run a pretty good meeting. I serve as chair of the Elizabeth River Trail Foundation. As I said, I've been president of the Downtown Civic League. I am on the board of the Norfolk Preservation Collective. I really immerse myself in those things, that the things that I consider to make Norfolk great, and Planning Commission is a big part of that. So it would mean a lot to me. Thank you.
Kevin, we appreciate that. Commissioners, do we have any questions of the candidates?
I do have a follow-up question, if that's okay.
Sure.
Matt and Kevin, you both spoke about being respectful of time and making sure everyone has a fair chance to speak. And I wondered, as you're thinking through everyone having a fair chance to speak, as it pertains to both applicants and even people who are opposed or wanted to voice their approval. And I'll just go ahead and share, just as a newish commissioner, how might you also include that, more be more inclusive of the commissioners being able to speak? And again, being mindful of everyone's time, but again, everyone having, that everyone is important to me, that everyone has a fair chance to speak, can be heard.
You know, certainly after every, before every vote, we give a chance for the commissioners to speak. You know, one of the things that you know, I'm going to enjoy, and I sent Earl a separate note on this one, is that I'm going to enjoy Earl being the longest person on the Planning Commission will actually vote first going forward. And I'm looking forward to his insight on these, what we're voting on prior to us voting on that. But, you know, every planning commissioner needs to make sure they have ample time to say what they need to say. Also ask questions of the applicants and anybody that opposes or disposes. So we need to make sure we keep that forum open for all the commissioners to continue to do that. I'm not a big fan of, the last thing I'll say is I'm not a big fan of, and I've turned them off a couple times, I'm not a big fan of having conversations of the any item outside the commission, because other people don't have the opportunity to hear somebody's thoughts or that. So I, you know, try to keep my comments, as well as hearing all the comments, make sure they're happening in a forum that we have in either a mid-month meeting or the actual planning commission public hearings. So, but no, I agree with you, Kim. It's very important that everyone has a say. Everyone gets a chance to speak.
Thank you, Matt. Kevin?
I would just say I'd like to encourage more discussion, in particular at the work sessions, and not just giving every commissioner the opportunity to speak, but to have actual conversations back and forth about issues. So it's less about making points and more about learning from the perspective that my fellow commissioners bring to the table.
Thank you for that. Any other follow-up questions, commissioners? We have any other follow-up questions or thoughts of the candidates? Hearing none, are we ready for the question?
Mr. Chair, this is Adam. I don't recall you all having a vote on an office with multiple nominees before.
Yes.
And I don't see anything in your rules of procedure specifically addressing that. So you can do it how you'd like to do it. I don't know if you were planning on calling for a vote on the first nominee first and then the second nominee after that. But I think that if a your rules do say that if a majority of the commissioners present and voting vote for the nominee for that office, then that person is appointed. So if you have a roster to go through, the commissioners just need to know ahead of time that if the first person called gets a majority, that will conclude the appointment for that office. We're not going to run through the rest of them. Does that make sense?
Makes all the sense in the world to me, Adam. Okay. Commissioners, you have any question or comment on that? When Adam is saying that the first candidate gets four votes, that's the majority. That person is the nominee or is the chairperson.
Appointed, right, right.
So I do have a question to clarify, Adam. So if the first name is called and we're not voting for that person, do we just not vote or do we say no?
If you would vote no on that person.
Okay, great.
I would be assuming you'd be voting yes on the other nominee.
Okay, yeah, I just wanted to make sure that we actually had to take an action, not just abstain or whatever, not just not vote. I got it. Thank you.
And Adam, the candidates do get a vote. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, with that, Ms. Pollock, if you would just call the roll on the first nominee for the chairmanship, Mr. Matt Hales. Susan Pollock.
Are you muted, Susan?
Sorry, I don't usually mute myself during these meetings. I forgot. Ms. Austin?
No, I would rather state the person's name, frankly.
It occurs to me we could do that way, too, with just two nominees. You could call the roll for which of the nominees? If Earl, do you want to do that?
That would be fine.
Okay, you're starting. Kevin Murphy.
Mr. Murphy.
Mr. Murphy.
Ms. Shelton.
Mr. Murphy.
Ms. Lloyd.
Dr. Lloyd.
Mr. Hales.
Ms. Sutter.
Mr. Murphy.
That concludes the nomination, does it not?
It does. You have a majority, Mr.
I have a majority for Mr. Hales. For Mr. Murphy. Congratulations, Kevin.
Thank you, sir. I don't look forward to following in your large footsteps. You've been a very excellent mentor and a distinguished commissioner and chair. So thank you for your leadership, and I'm so glad to hear that you are continuing to serve on the commission.
Well, I'm delighted that you get an opportunity to serve in that capacity. That was the whole purpose of my stepping down, so that others might have an opportunity. I didn't necessarily want to be chair for life, but I appreciate the opportunity that the CPC has been giving me over the years, and I'd just like to share the glory, if you will. With that, we close the nominations on the chair. Mr. Murphy, I guess that gavel now goes to you officially. Is that not true, Mr. Molina?
That's correct. Yes, that office election goes into effect immediately. But and you do have other offices to go vote on.
So, Mr. Murphy, I'm handing the ceremonial gavel virtually over to you, and you will call for the nominees for the vice chair.
Thank you, and I'm glad this is not happening during a public hearing because I feel utterly unprepared, but I'll do the best that I can to muddle through this. Next item on the agenda is to elect the 2022 vice chair, and I would like to start by nominating Matt Hales to continue serving as vice chair.
I would like to remove my name for that, please. I'm not interested in that.
We have any other nominations?
I'd like to nominate Kim Sutter.
We need a second.
We don't need a second. The floor is open for nominations until the chair closes up.
I would second that nomination.
Excellent. Any other nominations? All those in favor, please respond by saying an aye.
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 Opposed? Great, thank you. Congratulations, Kim. Next, we need to elect the representative to Architectural Review Board. Do we have any nominations for the representative to Architectural Review Board?
That's a role that you had previously held. Is that correct, Kevin?
That's correct, and I assume that that would no longer be my role.
I think that makes sense to me. Do we have any members of the CPC? And I'm not the chairman yet. I'm just asking.
I'm willing to do that role.
I would nominate Dr. Lloyd.
Do we need a second?
I second.
Great. Any other nominations? All right. All those in favor of Dr. Lloyd being the CPC representative to ARB? Respond by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye.
Great. Congratulations, Amanda. It's really worthwhile. It's a lot of work, but it's really worthwhile.
Thank you. If I have any questions, I know who to call.
Yeah.
There you go.
Exactly. Moving on, we're going to elect a representative to the Public Arts Commission. I believe Ms. Shelton currently serves in that role.
Nope, it's actually Ms. Austin. I stepped off pre-COVID, Mr. Chair. So I'm not sure exactly.
I'm sorry, I didn't recall that, Ms. Austin. Again, I didn't prepare to run the meeting, but are you interested in continuing to serve in that role?
Yes.
Anyone nominating Ms. Austin?
I'd like to nominate Ms. Austin.
I second.
Excellent. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Congratulations. Thank you for continuing to serve. Moving on to next item is a review of the CPC Policies and Procedures Handbook. Is that you, Adam?
It's not me. It's just a placeholder, I think, that we have every January, just in case. Sometimes George has ideas. I don't know of any. I didn't hear him. We haven't mentioned any during staff meetings. I've seen and referenced the procedures from time to time. I checked it again just now when we were conducting the election of officers. I'm not aware of any changes we need to make. I think there are electronic meetings provisions in there are pretty flexible and have accommodated what we've needed to do during the emergencies. George, do you know of anything that needs to be fixed or improved?
No, I do not. And as you indicated, this is a placeholder in case there's anything that the commissioners want to felt like need to be changed in how meetings are run or what have you. As all of you know from having a copy, it's kind of, sort of has everything. It's a soup to nuts type of approach. It tells what the order of the agendas are going to be and that kind of thing. As well as all that information that the chair reads out prior to every public hearing about the length of time that people can talk and rebuttal and all of that's in there. So unless you all think that there's something broken with the way we've been operating for the past, I think last time we changed it was about 6 years ago. So unless you think there's anything broken with that.
If I can add, this is not the only time when you can adjust it. It's just on here to remind you all that you do have that policy and that we can make adjustments from time to time. So if you haven't looked at it in a while and you look at it and you decide next month, there is something you think should be improved, just raise it at that point. But for action today, we don't have anything.
Excellent. Commissioners, anything to add? As suggested, please review the Policies and Procedures Handbook. And if you have any comments, bring them to future meetings. Moving on, now we'll have a presentation, the CPC Annual Report by Matthew Fraley. Matthew, are you there?
Yes, I am here. I'm pulling up my presentation right now.
Great.
Can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Matthew Straley. I'm the Geospatial Data Analyst for the Department of Planning, and I will be presenting the CPC annual report to you today. Sorry, just a second. All right. Can you still see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. Staff began preparing this annual report after 2011. This report summarizes all Planning Commission activity that you have seen in the past year, including public hearing items, architectural review board items, and other major initiatives. The 2021 report will be ready in draft form for Planning Commission review by mid-February. And once it is approved, it will be distributed to City Council and made available to the public. So let's dive right into some of the data around some of the applications that we've heard in the past year. In 2021, City Planning Commission met 22 times, holding 12 public hearings. In those meetings, Planning Commission reviewed 145 planning and zoning applications, along with 24 of the 71 ARB applications received last year. Let's take a more in-depth look at the planning and zoning applications that you guys heard in 2021. Conditional use permits made up the largest number of applications last year with 99, accounting for nearly 70% of all applications. Rezonings were next with 17, followed by right-of-way vacations, text amendments, plan amendments, and lastly by development certificates. This map shows the geographic distribution of all the applications by type reviewed by Planning Commission in 2021, minus those applications not tied to a specific address, such as text amendments or plan amendments. You can see by looking at the map, the greatest number of applications was found in the downtown and St. Paul's area, followed by the Railroad District, and Ocean View was last with its many short-term rental applications that you guys heard in 2021. As conditional use permits were the most common type of application, let's take a closer look at those now. As I mentioned earlier, Planning Commission reviewed 99 CUPs in 2020. This is slightly higher than the 10-year average of 96.7, but in 2021, CUPs accounted for nearly 70% of all applications, higher than the 10-year average of nearly 60%. Most common type of CUP application heard last year were short-term rentals with 20 applications, accounting for just over 20% of all the CUPs heard. Rounding out the top five CU application types were ABC off-premises. Third was auto-related, which includes auto storage, auto sales and auto repair, and car washes. Rounding out the bottom two were extended hours of operation and multifamily CUPs. Looking at the 10-year review of planning and zoning applications, there was a slight increase in the number of applications this year compared to 2019 and 2020. But of the 145 applications, it was still 9% less than the 10-year average of 161. The reduction in applications in 2019 and 2020 was a goal of the 2018 zoning ordinance, but then came along short-term rentals, pushing the numbers higher in 2021. In 2021, of 145 applications reviewed by Planning Commission, 91% were recommended for approval. Since 2012, 1,619 applications have been submitted to Planning Commission. 92% of those have been recommended for approval. The approval rate is relatively high, as staff works hard to ensure applications that don't measure up. We try to keep them off the public agenda, and we work with applicants to get something that staff can recommend approval of. To date, Council has agreed with Planning Commission on 95% of applications this year. Now, there still are three outstanding applications that have not been heard by City Council this year. There are updates to those. I will include those in the final report that you will receive in February. Since 2013, City Council has agreed with Planning Commission on almost 97% of all applications. The Planning Commission and Council have only disagreed 37 times out of 1,309 in the past 9 years. That's less than 3% of all applications. Taking a look at the ARB applications from 2021, ARB reviewed 71 applications. This is lower compared to the previous 2 years and lower than the 10-year average of 91. Nearly 96% of all ARB applications were approved, in line with the 10-year average of about 94%. Again, historic districts saw the most activity in 2021, with 25 certificates of appropriateness applications, which accounted for over a third of all ARB activity for the year. This next map and the data here is something new that we've added to this year's report. This shows new construction building permits issued in 2021. So in yellow, you see the single family home new construction building permits. All other new construction residential building permits are in purple, and non-residential new construction building permits are shown in red. You can see these really cover the entire area of the city, but there are large concentrations found in East Ocean View and in the Huntersville area of the city. Keeping in line with building permits, we can look at new housing units next. There really was a mixed bag in terms of new housing units in 2021. 2021 saw a 10-year low for new single-family home units built, with 290, which is below the 10-year average of 338, while two or more housing units set a 10-year high with 951 units, which is well above the 10-year average of 437. There were also 90 residential conversions completed in 2021. Some of the major projects that were completed last year that opened include Pinewell Station in Ocean View, the Tucker Library on the south side, and Waitzer Hall at EVMS. Again, this is just a small sampling of the projects. A more complete list of completed projects will be included in your final report. Planning Commission also participated in several major projects that were concluded in 2021, including the Broad Creek Refresh Plan that was adopted by City Council in July, and the Missing Middle Pattern Book, which was adopted by Council in June. Also in 2021, the Planning Department completed many other projects, including the Downtown Ocean View Project. We passed the Tree Protection Ordinance and saw the conclusion of the Historic Resources Survey Plan. No, not every project that we had anticipated being completed in 2021 was completed, but these will continue, work will continue on those into the future, including Plan Norfolk 2050 and a pattern book for home elevations. And again, this is just a sampling of the 2021 work program. A full listing will be provided in the final report. Here's a sampling of the 2022 work program initiative studies and plans that the Planning Department will either complete or start this year. And this includes many, a wide range of projects, including short-term rental revisions, outdoor dining guidelines, developing regulations for marijuana-related businesses, and converting legacy plan development districts to base zoning districts. And again, this is just not a complete listing of the 2022 work program that will be included in the final report. Again, the draft final report will be placed in your Dropbox by mid-February. Should you have any questions or comments, please feel free to reach out to me or to another staff member. Voting on adoption of the plan will occur at the February 24th public hearing. And once approved, staff will forward to City Council and make the report available to the general public. Thank you, and I'm available for questions.
Thank you, Matt, and I need to commend staff and my fellow commissioners. It's been quite a productive year. There's a lot in that report. Commissioners, any questions for Matt?
Matt, I appreciate the historical reference you put in there about how we stack up in 21 with the 9 or 10 year average. I think that speaks volumes to what we're trying to accomplish in terms of keeping the process moving, if you will. And I'm sure we can attribute a lot of that drop off in terms of numbers to the pandemic. Probably played a major role in that capacity, but notwithstanding that, we were still able to accomplish quite a few things. I think this report always opened my eyes, Mr. Chairman, because we sit here and do these things on a routine basis, it seems sometimes, and debate and discuss them. But in the final analysis, when you see how council has been standing behind us and having our back, if you will, and trusting our judgment, I think it speaks volumes for how we go about doing the things that we do. And of course, we take our head off the staff in every one of those capacities because they keep us straight. But I like the format of this report, and I think it captures quite significantly what we accomplished during some difficult times.
I have a quick question. After this is adopted and approved, does this go on the city website at all for the general public to view?
Yes, our department has a page with the reports going back to 2011, and this will be included with that once it is approved.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any other questions or reactions to the report? I, for one, was surprised we'd only seen 20 short-term rental applications. It felt like 200. That kind of jumped out. It was nice to see all the new home construction in Huntersville. That's really, it wasn't that way 5 years ago.
What jumped out at me was the fact that Dent appeared to have the most activity for short-term rentals. And for a district that houses so much of the historic architecture and represents civic, long civic history, I wonder how do we feel about that? Is it as appropriate as, say, someplace like Ocean View, which is very much at the heart of what goes on with resort activity in this area? What are the feelings about the people in Ghent about this? And Ghent really does supply a needed and very diverse housing stock for the for EVMS, for other mid-level professional people, as well as people who work in the various shops and whatnot around here. It has a very enviable mix of housing stock. How do we feel about this?
Matt, can you go back to that slide? I didn't glean what Ramona did from that part of the report.
I think it was, I think you went past, oh. There was another slide after this, you went past it, that specifically noted Ghent. Keep going. There it is.
That was ARB applications.
Yeah,
ARB applications.
ARB. I have short-term rentals on my mind.
Okay. I thought I missed something significant there.
That's ARB.
As a Ghent resident, I was also like glad Kevin said to go back. I'm like, wait, what? Very good. We're used to being the heart of the ARB activity, that's for sure.
Yes.
But I do think Ramona makes a good point that I hope that we can be mindful of going forward. And I know that we have tortured the short-term rental thing over and over again at different meetings, but I do hope we can set aside some time to have some discussions of sort of the state of that and coming out with more policies and plans as we move forward. Because I do think that, I mean, while they're not being approved here in my neighborhood, they're still operating without approval. And I just, like I said, I know we've tortured this to death, but I hope that it's something that we can all take up and continue discussion on in the future. And I know Ramona feels the same way.
Absolutely. Yes.
Do we want to make this discussion, you know, there's a certain time where it's important to bring in the communities as a whole of the city. I mean, do we want at some point to put forward what we think after we get there, what we think works best for the city in order to inform the public for their support?
I think there's evidence that the way it's being handled now is working well. And I think that that should, excuse me, as we get more and more applications, we should continue to get report outs on the performance of those who are permitted, and share that with the public, and then react if necessary. Any other comments or questions, commissioners? When does this go to council?
February.
So if we can review this between meetings and get comments to Matt, please do so before the February vote. All right, everybody comfortable moving on to the next agenda item? Thank you. Next agenda item is a discussion zoning text amendment cleanup. Austin Peters, I saw Austin there.
Good afternoon, commissioners. Nice to see you all again for what feels like our biannual appointment at this point. We've got these down about twice a year now, and we're back with another set of revisions. Give me just a second to share my screen here. And I'll just go through these briefly. Since it's the month before, and this is more of just a preview, but again, if anybody has any questions, please feel free to stop me, and I'd be happy to answer, or I can take questions at the end, whatever y'all prefer. So I'll just run down the list here. To start off with, we wish to modify a provision for substantially improved non-conforming structures located in the flood zone. Currently, as it reads, there's a provision that requires that substantially improved structures in the flood zone require or they need to match the pattern of the neighborhood. However, there's no real mechanism to capture this, so we're proposing to require that these projects go and receive a determination of architectural appropriateness from the Architectural Review Board. Secondly, we wish to clarify a footnote found in the intensity and dimensional standards for some residential zonings, primarily single family zonings. There are some existing lots that are deemed conforming, although they are just slightly under the minimum lot width or lot size. We wish to just make that provision a little more clear because we've had a couple applicants be unclear about it over the past year. Third, we would like to allow for further elevated home construction in the RC zoning district, which is along the coast, primarily Ocean View. There's currently a provision that inadvertently limits the ability for homes to be elevated with a garage on the bottom, which is something we would like to promote since it's one of the most flood prone areas in our community. So we would just like to clarify that note and make it a little bit easier to build those elevated homes in the RC zoning district. Next, we would like to allow for veterinary hospitals or clinics in the BCO zoning district. We currently allow veterinary hospital or clinics in just about every commercial zoning except for O and BCO, and I believe CN, but we had an applicant come through a few months ago, and this seems like an appropriate zoning district for a veterinary hospital or clinic, but we would also, since it is still partially an office environment, we would like to prohibit open exercise runs as well to make it a little more compatible with the zoning district. Next, we would like to allow, this is kind of a two-parter, but we would like to create a use that is called renewable energy manufacturing and make it a P/C use in all industrial based zonings and the BCI, Business Commerce Industrial Zoning District. The purpose of this is to allow for Norfolk to be kind of on the forefront of manufacturing these renewable energy, these renewable energy manufacturing components, such as solar panels and associated things. And associated with that, we would like to make heavy and light manufacturing, assembly or fabrication, a P/C use in the IDW zoning district for the same reason. So if there's something connected directly to the water and it has to do with these renewable energies, we would like to make that a permitted use in the IDW zoning district if it meets those criteria. Next, we would like to correct conditions in which a warehouse or wholesale establishment requires a conditional use permit. We actually did this about a year ago in February. However, the language wasn't, we overlooked a couple things, and we would like to make it a little more clear and clean it up just a bit more to make it clear that a conditional use permit is not required in the BCO and the BCI zoning districts, which are business commerce, office park, and business commerce industrial zoning districts. For number seven, we would like to allow the community garden use in the historical based zoning districts. We had a request for this, and it is not allowed in the historical based zoning districts as it stands. We would like to make that amendment. Next, we would like to specify that attached accessory dwelling units shall also maintain the architectural design, style, appearance, and character of the principal dwelling. Currently, as the code reads, only detached accessory dwelling units have to maintain the same design, style, appearance, and character as the principal dwelling. This wasn't the intent, so we would like to make it a little more clear that all accessory dwelling units, attached or detached, have to maintain the character of the principal dwelling. And then we would like to remove accessory dwelling unit and put everything under the performance standard just to make it a little more clean and a little more clear. Next, we would like to address daycare homes under 5,000 square feet. Currently, they are not specifically mentioned in the daycare home performance standards. We would like to just make it clear that under 5,000 square feet, daycare homes are not permitted, which was the intent when that code was written. Next, we would like to establish that a garage shall be considered to only accommodate one motor vehicle parking space for all residential uses. This provision currently applies to single family homes, but not to anything else such as a two family or a townhome or other similar uses. So we would like to make that clear and modify that.
Austin.
Next. Sure.
Before you get too far gone, can we go back to this ADU issue you just mentioned?
Sure, yeah. What's your question?
Did I understand you say that, well, let me say it this way. I was under the impression that an ADU was an attached, a detached unit.
So an accessory dwelling unit, it has to have three things to really make it an accessory dwelling unit. It has to have a dedicated sleeping area, a dedicated kitchen, and a dedicated bathroom. And it has to be just kind of isolated from the unit itself. And there are a few other provisions that it has to have. But it can be attached to the house as well as a detached accessory structure. In the past year, for example, I've seen a few of them that have put them right over top of a garage because they fit right into that space where they have the two-story home and the one-story garage. So they'll do an addition on top of the garage and make that an accessory dwelling unit with maybe a separate staircase in the rear. So that's something I've seen a few times, but they can be attached or detached.
All right. Well, thanks for that clarification. When I think of an ADU, I generally think of a detached or a semi-attached living space. But you're telling me that a room over the garage could be an accessory dwelling unit.
Well, yes, but those were going to be segregated in some way from the principal dwelling, so they won't have a direct door connection most of the time. Or maybe they'll share hallway sometimes, but usually they just have a wall in between them.
But they need to have a separate exterior entry.
Yes.
Okay, so. I'm sorry. I just wanted clarity on that.
That's quite all right. Yeah, it's a confusing section, which is why we would like to clarify it. I believe I was on number 11. We would like to, for that one, we would like to clarify that driveways are allowed in the front yard for access, but not for parking in townhomes, two-family, and single-family semi-detached dwellings. This is a problem that's popped up a few times over the past year, because we do allow driveways and accesses in these front yards. However, we do not allow parking. So we'd like to modify the text to make that clear that parking is not permitted, but you can use the front yard for a driveway or access to parking, maybe on the side or the rear. Next, we would like to add a reference to our existing prohibited plant list that is located in our procedures manual, in our landscaping standards section. That's a pretty clear one. We just don't reference it directly in the zoning ordinance, and we'd like to fix that. We would also like to correct the open space standards to remove a direct contradiction with the downtown zoning district requirements. In the open space standards as it stands, there are certain standards for downtown, however, or for the downtown based zoning districts as a whole. However, in some of these downtown based zoning districts, there are different open space standards. And since those are a direct contradiction, the more restrictive will win, which is in the open space standards, which is not the intent. So we would just like to clarify and remove that direct contradiction. Next, we would like to create a path to allow for alternative garage location with a determination of architectural appropriateness. Currently, single-family homes located single-family homes can ask for a waiver from our form standards, provided that they go to ARB and get a determination of architectural appropriateness. Now, they're allowed to modify the form standards for anything other than finished floor height, which is a part of our resilience quotient, and garage location. We would like them to be able to ask for an exemption from the form standards, typical garage locations, provided that there is a 16-foot maximum garage door width. And I just noticed that there's a typo there. I'll fix that. And the reason for this is over the past year, I think we've had two or three cases that people have wanted an alternative garage, and instead of having an avenue that looks for design and fit with the neighborhood, they have gone to the Board of Zoning Appeals and been approved for an alternative garage that way. And that really wasn't the intent of that. We, instead of them asking for a variance, we would prefer that they have design experts look at this and make an informed decision based on the neighborhood instead of getting a variance. And then finally, we would like to clarify how an abandoned non-conforming use may continue in a historic or architecturally significant property. It's just the language is unclear, so we would like to change a few things around and make it clear the criteria and the process to continue an abandoned non-conforming use in historic or architecturally significant property. And that's the last one, number 15 there. Are there any questions about any of these items? I'd be happy to revisit any of them.
Commissioners, any questions or comments? All right, that's a lot to process. Austin, thanks for all your work on that.
No problem, and it is a lot. This one is a little bit bigger than the past two we've done. So if you're reading over this and you have any questions that you think about later, feel free to shoot me an email as well.
Great, thank you very much.
Excuse me, Kevin, Austin, you said it's in the Dropbox or it's going to be in the Dropbox, right?
Yes, it's not there right now. This has been a very, it's been evolving constantly. So I think this was done as of this morning because of a few last minute tweaks. So it will be in the Dropbox, but it's not currently.
Got you. Just wanted to make sure, because I didn't see it. I wanted to make sure I wasn't missing it. Thank you so much. I'll look at it when it gets there. Thanks.
Thank you.
I keep adding stuff. Sorry.
Keep on adding.
Moving on down the agenda, next is our January public hearing preview. It's a robust agenda, but I encourage commissioners to ask questions or make comments. We review the agenda and so that we can, excuse me, get these things worked out before the public hearing. Thank you, Susan.
And the first two, we'll start off with Joy. These were continued from last month. Go ahead, Joy.
Yes, thank you, Susan. So I'm going to sort of talk about the next two Richmond wholesale deals as if they are They're very, very similar. So I'm just going to talk about them all at once, even though they are two separate properties. They are both south of East Ocean View Avenue, and they both lie in the East Ocean View neighborhood. This particular one is on 15th Bay Street. The other one is on 14th. Next slide, please. And of course, it's for short-term rental. Both apartment buildings are 6-unit apartment buildings. If you recall, what triggered the request to delay this for another month was the immediate the adjacent property owner, Mr. Russell, who owns the property next to. I'm sorry. Can we go back one more? Thank you. The property owner adjacent to 9608 15th Bay Street, Mr. Russell, he owns the house just north of our subject property. Even though he owns the property, he currently does not live there. He has renters living there. He is active duty, and he was unable to attend the neighborhood meeting that the applicant, Mr. Miller, hosted. And Mr. Russell had a large number of questions that couldn't be resolved during last month's public hearing. So in order for the two neighbors to get together, this was delayed another month. They did have a meeting earlier this month, and I think it was very productive. I'm hoping Mr. Russell will be attending the public hearing next later this month, so he can discuss his personal feelings, because it wasn't very clear to me. I think I did attend that meeting. I did observe the meeting. I don't really want to speak for Mr. Russell on to whether he supports or does not support the short-term rental, specifically here on 15th Bay Street. But I can say that they did part on good terms, both Mr. Miller and Mr. Russell. Okay, next slide, please. And next slide. And here we see a picture of the property. And staff is recommending some landscaping improvements and improvements to the drive apron, which, as you can see, has a tendency to pool. Pool water. Next slide, please. And one of the requests that was made during the public hearing was, can we get some pictures of the sides of these properties? And if the rear is all the way to the back of the lot, but I was able to get these side images. Next slide, please. And I was able to get some proposed renovations from the applicants. As you can see, we have a list there of proposed improvements to interior and exterior. None of these, though, I will point out, are going to be recommended as part of the CUP. Next slide, please. Here we have a artist rendition of what the exterior is going to look like if this gets approved as a short-term rental. And again, though, exterior improvements such as this typically aren't part of CUP recommendations. Next slide, please. Again, we see an image of the neighborhood. Next slide, please. Okay, and then this is for the other property on 14th Bay Street. Next slide, please. It's also a zone RC, also in the East Ocean View neighborhood, south of, that's fine. And here we see staff recommend improvements, significant amount of landscaping, and again, replacement of the drive apron. Next slide, please. Once again, we see images of the sides look very similar to the previous building. Next slide, please. And then this is just a repeat of what we saw before. Next slide, please. And next slide. And hey, once again, image of the neighborhood. It is a bit of a mix of multifamily, single family for both properties. And that concludes my preview for these two particular properties. Are there any questions?
Commissioners, any questions or comments? Thank you, Joy.
I do have a comment. I still am looking for, I think we need, and I hope there's some other input on this, a more detailed sense of what's happening here. Other projects that have been put forth have been much more developed, so we know what we're getting. There's not much that has been added to this from the last time in terms of the drawing is the same, the elevation rather, and we still are not getting a sense of the building from the other direction than what we originally were given it. We've gotten side views. It's not as coherent as it could be in order for us to know really what we're getting.
Well, I concur. So,
Ms. Austin, what we had talked about was if they are making any changes to the building, henceforth we would ask for elevations. But when they are not proposing any modifications, what you see is what you get. And in this case, Joy, correct me if I'm wrong,
that's what comes across, is that is exactly what comes across, in which case I would have to vote no for the project.
To you.
But these were the artist renditions that the applicant provided for us.
Anyone else? Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I will say this. This short-term rentals give me all manner of heartburn. And I know we're navigating our way through this. I think Ms. Austin makes a valid point, as you indicate. We lose quite a bit when we don't get our field trip in. A lot of the circumstances that we're discussing in this particular case are typically resolved in our field trip. So that's why we're asking staff, give us a little bit more, because you know we can ride around the block when we're on that field trip and we can see all sides of it. And this, generally speaking, this short-term rental, I was looking at the report earlier, the annual report. I'm beginning to think that we need to look more heartily at how these short-term rentals impact communities. I know we got an isolated feedback from the neighbor here and the neighbor there, but these things are becoming coagulated, if you will. They're ganging up in some areas in our city, and at some point they're going to have an impact on communities. And I think the more information we get, pictures, photos, videos, all of this serves to put us in a better position to have a more thorough picture of what we're dealing with.
I agree with you, Mr. Fraley. I've often thought about there's going to come a tipping point where folks will be surrounded by short-term rentals, and I often wonder what those impacts might be on the community.
And we may have some of those already, too often, too many of our citizens complain to their neighbor, but won't call the city council person, or won't call the city or ask questions. And in many instances, unfortunately, we got to be their eyes and ears. And the more information we have. So I know this is an added burden for staff, but we didn't bring on the pandemic either. But and we want to represent your work thoroughly when we make recommendations to council. And the more information we have on
So, okay. So may I ask?
Sure.
Sorry. So may I ask the commissioners, I know it sounds like you would like to have more of a 360 image of the property. Is that what I'm hearing? I can try to go. Here's the thing though. Both buildings are pushed all the way to the rear of the lot. So getting access to the rear lot would be difficult for me. I will say that. And it's also a very narrow lot. So getting any other image of the property other than straight on and then going towards the parking lot and getting pictures on the side was about as best as I could get. But if I could get some more specifics on how I can fulfill what the commissioners are looking for, that would be helpful. Because clearly I thought I was fulfilling the needs, but I guess I fell short.
Oh, Joy, this is not a complaint. Please don't interpret it as such. And I'm not suggesting that you should climb over fences and avoid the barking dogs in the backyard. I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm merely saying it's like your first remark there. As close to 360 as you can get would certainly give me a little bit less anxiety. And I realize that, you know, you can't go on private property and don't want you knocking on doors and giving away the trade secrets. But just as much as you can give us in terms of the surround of that property, the 360 as you indicated, maybe even a video might even work. I don't know how we work that in our virtual Zoom meetings, but you know, I look at our planning function like I look at the appraisal fund. The appraiser's best friend is information, and I think in these short-term rentals, the more information, whether it be pictorial information, feedback from neighbors, anything you can give us to help minimize my trepidation. I just see this short-term rental is continuing to grow. I think I won't call the pandemic a blessing, but I shudder to think if we were not in the pandemic, how many of these short-term rentals we would be looking at. And as we ease out of this, I suspect we're going to be seeing more and more. So in order for us to be consistently thorough in our recommendations, the more information we have, the better position we're in to make a recommendation. And that's based on the information you guys give us. If it's a 360, if it's a walk around the corner, whatever the situation is, that can provide us as near a picture as possible as what we're dealing with.
Thanks for everyone's comments. And I'll add that just in general, and this would apply to all short-term rental applications, is we cannot allow these to have a negative impact on the neighborhood that they're going into. And they need to be building value in the neighborhood. And some applicants have demonstrated that they can help improve the neighborhood and build value and be good neighbors. And the onus needs to be on the applicant to make it clear to the commission that their short-term rental is going to build value in the neighborhood. And if it's not clear to the commissioners, I am going to be one who votes no. Any other comments?
Can I just get some clarification? So when we say 360, do we mean 360 of the short-term rental building or a 360 of the neighborhood or both?
Both.
I would just like to add to what is said is that we need a narrative that gives us a sense of who is doing this, how they're doing it, and as Kevin says, what value is it going to add? How are they imagining this project to add value to the neighborhood? Getting that narrative is what will help us, Joy. I think that's what we're looking for.
And just one more comment. I'm going to go cranky on y'all for a minute. You know, we as staff are not taking you out to the sites. However, that doesn't mean you can't go out to the sites on your own. And I would heavily suggest it because you all need to know, you know, you can't, a picture is helpful, but it's not like going out to the site. So I would highly recommend that you all, if you've got questions about these sites, please go out and see them.
I echo that comment. Thank you, Susan, for making it. Are we ready to move along down the agenda? Regular agenda. Item one, City Planning Commission text amendments.
Yes, thank you. That's mine as well. So if you recall, last month we tentatively spoke about a proposed text amendment to add a new definition to the visitor accommodation category to be called inn, to sort of fulfill the gap in between bed and breakfast and hotels. So as you see on the slide there, there's been a few changes. Last time we saw this, in the location, the proposed location of the inn more closely matched what where bed and breakfasts were. Now we have revised that, and they pretty much meet or match, I should say, the location requirements, if I can say that, for hotels. We are not recommending inns to be located in any residential districts. We are recommending that wherever a hotel is allowed by right or by conditional use, inn will follow. Hotels are allowed in all commercial districts. Inns will also be allowed in all commercial districts by right. Hotels are allowed in all downtown districts by right. Same for inns. This is where we deviate somewhat. Hotels are not allowed in any of the historic districts. However, we are recommending that inns be allowed by conditional use permit only in all the historic districts. And then a few hotels are also allowed in a few smattering of special districts. We are also recommending that inns be allowed by right in a few special districts. Next slide, please. So what does the inn look like? After some feedback from the public, we've kind of modified the definition of the inn. We still have the inn at a certain age, at 40 years old. Obviously, lodging units no more than 30 days. Much like hotels, we are recommending that inns be allowed to offer amenities to their guests, including to do not only their guests, but to the public as well, including pools or fitness rooms or dining rooms or business centers, restaurants, and spa amenities. Bed and breakfasts require on-site management. Either the owner needs to live there or the manager needs to live there. And then, of course, hotels have 24 hours management. The inns will be sort of a hybrid, where on-site management will be required to be on-site from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. However, all other times, inns shall provide a method for guests to request assistance, and that assistance, the manager essentially needs to be able to respond within 30 minutes. At least one bathroom will be provided at least one bathroom will be provided for each 1.5 guest bedrooms. And then at least one meal per day must be offered to the guests staying at the facility. Next slide, please. We'll quickly go over the CUP options. Typically, inns will have no more than 15 guest rooms. Just for comparison, hotels must have at least 10 guest rooms or more, and bed and breakfasts, depending on their location, are limited to 5 or 7 guest rooms. So inns will be a little bit more. If an inn would like to request more than 15 guest rooms, they will have the option to apply it through a CUP. When each guest bedroom does not include a private bathroom with toilet, sink, and bath or shower, they do have the option to apply for a CUP to reduce the minimum amount of bathrooms available to each guest room, but no less than one point, no less one bathroom. I'm sorry, just give me one moment to remove my cat. Apologize. Let me start over. So there is an option to request for less than one private bathroom per guest room. However, no less than 1.5 per guest room. When the inn does not provide on-site management at all times, while the lodging unit is occupied, they will have to apply for a CUP. And then the conditional use permit, actually, this is a little bit, I'll have to modify this, I'm sorry. Typically, either if they're allowed permitted by right or through conditional use permit, there will be an expiration date of 5 years unless the CUP grants it for longer. Next slide, please. Parking spaces, we're recommending 0.67 spaces per guest room, plus one more for employees in the downtown districts, and in all the other districts, one per guest room, plus one additional for employee. Next slide, please. Oh, sorry, and that's the end of my slides. Sorry for the interruption. If you have any questions, it was a little confusing. I apologize.
Joy, how do we arrive at the five-year expiration? Has that been...
That came out from comments from some of the citizens in the Ghent neighborhood. They were a little concerned when they found out that typically CUPs run with the land and not necessarily with the applicant. And even though they are very, they were concerned about that fact. So that was in response to their concerns.
Commissioners, questions?
Joy, did you say when you were, if you could go back, or you don't have to go to the slide, but you said 5 years unless it was something different in the CUP. So is the maximum 5 years, or could a CUP go for longer? So you're saying unless a longer period is granted. So if we grant a longer period than the 5 years, depending on a case-by-case basis, that can happen?
Correct.
Okay, great. And one other question, when you talk about the inn being, services at the inn being able to serve not just their guests, but the public, would we have the ability by CEP to put any limit on the number of people that are non-guests that can take part in the restaurant or the meeting rooms or that sort of thing? I'm not saying I want to do that. I'm just asking if that's a possibility, because I know I'm going to get asked that question by my neighbors.
Yes, if it requires a CUP, that is definitely something that we can make as part of the CUP.
And I would just add to that, if you don't mind me enhancing your answer, Joy.
Please do.
It would still have to meet the test of whether or not the imposition of that condition or that limitation ameliorates some sort of negative impact that is expected to happen without that constraint. So if the idea is you'll have too many people coming from somewhere else and they're going to bring their cars and other stuff and there's not enough parking, or the parking necessarily is going to impact the availability of street parking, then that would be a perfectly fine reason. And there may be other perfectly fine reasons, but
I just want to make sure I can explain the distinguishing between meetings of like a board meeting in a boardroom or a wedding, right? So
you'd want to understand why it is that you wouldn't want to allow unlimited public visitors at the facility.
Great, thank you. I appreciate that.
Why is parking being required downtown?
That's a good question, because typically downtown doesn't require parking, especially for
So there is parking required in the Fort Norfolk area, not in the rest of the area. So that's what that is. We do that with every use.
Got it. Thank you.
And
other questions or comments?
Yeah, if I could say one more thing. So, you know, as we start working with these applicants and they start explaining how they want to use this space, we may start telling them, look, we're going to need a floor plan done by an architect because we want to make sure you meet building code. So that may go towards your question, Kathy, about what kind of capacity they can have.
Other questions or comments? This is a lot of information to digest before the public hearing, so I look forward to reviewing it. And if you have questions, please reach out to staff. And we'll discuss again when we preview the agenda at our next work session.
Can we get this whole presentation? I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. Can we get this whole presentation in the Dropbox a few days before the meeting, if possible, or at least pieces of it like this that are a little more complicated and new, maybe?
The slides.
Yeah, or I mean, I know you're going to do the staff report, but yeah, I guess I'll just wait for the staff report. Sorry. I was just thinking it's easier for me. I mean, it's we're all aware that I'm going to have my neighbors are going to ask me a million questions about this. And I want to make absolutely sure that I don't say something that's not correct of what we're going to be talking about. And I know that there'll be a public hearing and they'll see that and they can go to that. But as you can imagine, sometimes people don't want to wait to discuss.
Yeah. And Sherry can correct me if I'm wrong, or maybe I can ask her to put the PowerPoint on the Dropbox so you have that as well.
Yeah, that would just be helpful just because I know sometimes the staff reports can change up until, you know, pretty close to the time. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
And Ms. Shelton, on this one, you'll need the benefit of the summary or the staff slide presentation version of it. But when the staff report's ready, the full text amendment will also be ready. It's going to be a little hard for a non-technical person to unpack because it's going to have use tables where the use is being introduced, and it's going to have a clip from the parking section where we've slipped it in and showed how it interfaces with parking. So there's going to be a lot of specifics in there, but it will be the actual language and the performance standards, and that is a piece of information that people who really want to understand what's proposed here will want to see. So that's quite a few number of pages, and those will be ready, but probably not before the staff report's ready.
I appreciate just anything. As you can imagine, it's a hot topic, and so just anything that can make it cool off a little bit and people wait for the public hearing, I just appreciate any support I can get.
And because the final staff report hasn't been completed, I guarantee you there'll probably be tweaks to these slides.
Yeah, point of clarification, that's probably just humor me. The 0.67 spaces per guest for downtown has to do with the fact of how many cars people are actually going to have using a downtown facility.
This parking requirement matches bed and breakfast.
But for downtown specifically.
Yes.
Specifically. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks everyone. Robert, I guess you're up next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a rezoning of 2601, 2605, 2611 Lafayette Boulevard, and then 3131 and 3133 Lenz Avenue. So this is on the south side of Lafayette between Argonne and Lenz Avenues. It's currently vacant land, and the applicant is rezoning the property so they can construct Fire Station 11 for the city of Norfolk. Slide, please. Thank you. So they want to use those five parcels there to build a new station. The original station is a block over or two. It was built in 1923. It's outdated and too small. This is going to require architectural review and site plan review. So that's why we're not going to get like a full rendition now. But they're going to be rezoning those five properties from CC, SFT, and PCO Lafayette to community commercial. Next slide, please, Sherry. This is the conceptual site plan. We don't have the renderings yet because those are probably still going to change, but this at least shows you what the site will look like. You can see on the left there, cars, the fire trucks will enter and then they will exit out the right side. And then there's a secure parking lot in the south
for the firefighter vehicles, like their personal cars.
Robert, can you slide back one slide?
Mm-hmm.
So when I look at these pink squares, where's the fire station going?
The fire station is going in the five parcels highlighted in black.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I missed that before. And the other parcels are?
It's those five. It's the three across Lafayette Boulevard that to me look like a gray color. And then the two below it on the right side of the street that are in yellow.
Okay. All right.
Next slide, please, Chair. Thank you. So this is how the site currently looks. It's vacant right now. The city owns these properties. And again, this will go through full site plan review. Are there any other questions?
Just a comment, commissioners. This has been on the drawing board in our city, it seems, 8 or 10 years. So the light of the city, we're moving forward with that. That fire station over in the Fairmont Park area. It's about as big as my garage. It's amazing how they operate out of that place. And it's got to be an historic building. So it'd be interesting to see how that evolves going forward. But
does anybody know what the plans are for that old fire station in Fairmont Park?
We have asked, there is no decision or direction yet as to what that the old fire station is going to be turned into.
I'm just curious.
And just to let you all know, this did go for the first shot through ARB on Monday. They did have some comments, so that's why we're not really ready to show you too much yet, but they will be coming back and you will get to see it.
Okay. And if we could, and I don't know who the appropriate, I don't know if it's fire or city real estate or development, but if we could maybe ask the question about what might happen to that and if it was going to be an RFP process, it would just be interesting to know if the city is going to decide that they're going to, you know, put that as excess property and go through some kind of RFP process.
Oh, you're talking about the existing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, John Alford is the one we've been working with, and he indicated the city doesn't know. I know I've gotten calls on perhaps reusing as residential. So I don't know what
I mean, we know, you know, from being around a while, we know when this kind of thing happens a lot of times that, there's not maybe enough neighborhood involvement in deciding what goes forward. And then plans, we issue RFPs, and then all of a sudden the neighborhood gets involved and then we change everything. So, and I'm saying we as the, when I was in the city. So if it's just a way that, I just think for us to know what might be coming would be a nice thing.
Very good. Any other questions or comments? Thank you, Robert. You doing the commissary kitchen also?
Yes, sir. So this is 3351 Chesapeake Boulevard. It's the west side Chesapeake Boulevard across from Robin Hood Road, I believe. The parcel is outlined in gray right there, and it's basically right at that intersection. It's currently commercial, and they're proposing to amend the conditional rezoning. Next slide. So this property was conditionally rezoned to C2 corridor commercial in 2012. This is the same as our CC zoning right now. During that conditional rezoning, the uses restricted to all uses allowed in the C1 limited commercial, which is now called which now neighborhood commercial district, and also allowed eating establishments and eating and drinking establishment. The applicant proposes to use the building as a commercial kitchen, which is not allowed under the current, under the old conditions. So to allow the use, the applicant is rezoning the property and amending the permitted uses. And we'll go through the uses that will be allowed in this district on the next slide. So the site can be used as a restaurant or a commercial kitchen. The hours for any restaurant will be limited to 6 a.m. till 9 p.m. Sunday through Thursday, and then until 10 o'clock on Friday and Saturday.
The commissary kitchen or the commercial, that's the name of the application. The commercial kitchen will be available for use 24 hours, 7 days a week. So the other uses that were left over from the C1 district that are going to be allowed under this proposed rezoning are school, vocational, or trade. Vocational school or trade school, art studio or school/gallery, music, dance, or martial arts studio, office, office contractor, office medical or dental, restaurant, and commercial kitchen. The applicant does intend to allow other businesses to use the existing commercial kitchen, including different vendors. So people will come there, take their food trucks, or just other vehicles around the back, and they will cook in the kitchen and then load up and take their food to be sold elsewhere.
Thank you for that, Robert. I was about to ask you, what is a commercial kitchen?
Sherry, I think I have some site photos on the next slide, right? Thank you. So this is how it looks in the front, and then there's 7 parking spaces off to the side on the right there, and then in the back there's an area for the food trucks and for any catering type vehicle to pull in to load up and deliver the food from there.
It's inside of the old Jesse's Kitchen on right next to Murray Crow Locksmith on right there at Robinwood Road, isn't that?
That is.
Right. And the applicant will be using this. Food trucks will go in there and cook, load this stuff up, and go to their destination.
I don't know if it's so much cooking in there. I think what they do is when they're done, they need a place to store their food because their trucks aren't running, so there's no electric. Right. So they bring it in here and they store it. But yes, people will also use the kitchen to cook for, you know, caterers will do it sometimes. They'll pre-cook the meal and then bring it somewhere.
And there will not be any restaurant-style service at this site. Is that correct?
Not in my understanding.
Yeah, this applicant doesn't intend to use it that way, but the conditional zoning would allow it to become a restaurant if something happened.
Thank you.
That makes sense. I know that's what happened with the sandwich shop on Collie. Started out commercial kitchen, then started to expand more.
They have to make a presentation if those changes occur, correct? They have to come back to us? If it's allowed, but turning it into something different wouldn't be an occasion for them to come back to us in some way?
Not unless the new use required a CUP.
If it was just a restaurant and they were just limited to the restaurant hours with no entertainment and no late hours, then they would not come back.
Now, I'm assuming that this is set up this way to allow them the flexibility to be able to operate, you know, to stay in operation both from the commercial kitchen aspect or if there was a downturn in that to be able to operate from more of a traditional restaurant perspective. So it does give a lot more flexibility for them to continue to be able to survive on the commercial kitchen side if they know they have the other ability as well. So.
And Susan, correct me if I'm wrong, this is the one of the applicants' two sites that they're gonna be operating?
They're working on another site. They're not quite there yet, but they're working on one. I think it's 2400, is it Alabama? It's one of the A streets.
Yeah, Alabama.
Susan, so if this applicant decides that he wants to now evolve into a restaurant, as long as he's not, doesn't have any alcoholic beverages or entertainment, he can do that without coming to us. Is that correct?
But yeah, now we're going to have to work with him on the parking because, you know, that's going to bring in an additional use. The use, yes, would be allowed, but we would want to talk to him about where is he going to park that.
And he could do alcohol. I mean, if he's closing at 11 p.m. and he doesn't have any entertainment, you can do a restaurant with alcohol with a zoning certificate. No CUP.
Great. Everyone clear on the application? No more questions? Then we'll move on. I think Joy's back up for the Monument Company's application.
Yes, sir. So as already mentioned, this is a Monument Company project. It is located in the Park Place neighborhood, east of Colonial Avenue and south of 35th Street and north of Lambert's Point Road. Next slide, please. They are proposing up to 60 apartments in the existing church, and then an additional 6 townhouses on the property to the south of the church, which was the former church's parking lot, I believe. So what they need to do for that to happen is they need to get a rezoning from institutional to multifamily, and then they need a conditional use permit to allow for more than 24 dwelling units. They are also underway of applying for a historic landmark designation for the historic wing of the church. Next slide, please. As we can see, it's a beautiful structure. I believe it was built in the 1920s. and then you see an image of the parking, gravel parking lot across the street. The layout that you have there in the bottom corner of your slide, you can see the church on the left side. And on the right side is where the parking lot would be for the apartments and then the proposed 6 townhouses. We do not have elevations at this time for the townhouses. We're hoping possibly that we might get some before the public hearing, but at this time we don't have any. Next slide, please. The neighborhood is predominantly, there is some commercial just north of the northeast of the subject property. However, the majority of the neighborhood is residential, mostly single family with some multifamily. That concludes my preliminary report for this particular project. I am available for questions.
Thank you, Joy. Questions, commissioners?
Joy, I just want to be clear. The church building itself is going to be modified into apartments?
Yes, the interior, yes.
Okay. And we got 6 townhouses going?
Up to 6 townhouses. Up to 60 apartments in the church and up to 6 townhouses. But that may be modified. I'm sorry.
Those townhouses will be located on the parking lot, the gravel lot we saw there. Is that correct?
Correct. Can we go back to the slide where we have they're all going to be facing Colonial, and they will all be rear loaded.
Okay. And the parking lot, will that be paved?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, that whole thing will have to go through site plan review. I think she did the site. They are applying for historic tax credits for the church. But as I think you all know, that kind of puts it on hold for 5 years and they can't really do much. And that's why we asked them, they didn't have to do it, but we asked them to also do a Norfolk Historic Landmark. And that is technically rezoning, and they're going to do that. So they'll go to ARB next Monday to get them to agree to add it into the to create an overlay, is how we do it, as a historic landmark. And that way, in perpetuity, if any changes are made to the exterior, ARB gets to see them.
And the townhouses will be aesthetically consistent architecturally with the church?
Yeah, you know, I think they're kind of like what they did at the school on Llewellyn. I think they're going to be similar. They are going to draw up, I don't know if we'll get elevations. What they want to do is draw up architectural guidelines. And you'll see that the intent will be to match what's in the neighborhood.
Susan or Joy, has Monument gone to the neighborhood on this project yet?
Yes.
And they've gotten positive feedback?
Yeah, they went both to the board and then to the Civic League.
And from what I understand, the orientation of the townhomes was a response to feedback from the Civic League. So they've been working closely together. Other questions or comments on this application?
Mr. Chairman, Monument, I am delighted to see that something meaningful is taking place with this building. And delighted we got a company like Monument that has the unique insights to be able to do something to salvage some of these utilization, this alternative uses, just working out great in many instances for us in our city. A monument has just done three or four projects that I've seen of theirs have just been remarkable.
So Earl, and as you know, with the Boys and Girls Club, they had those two large spaces and they were only allowed to kind of convert one of them into apartments to break it up. So they left the gymnasium or most of the gymnasium as one unit. I think it's like a 5,000 square foot unit.
Right.
They are trying to work with the Virginia Department of Historic Resources to see if there's anything they can do with the sanctuary in this building. I don't know if it's looking promising, but it is a beautiful sanctuary. So we'll see where they end up.
Yeah. Well, we have a number of these abandoned church structures around the city. So bringing them back online for get some utility out of them. Otherwise, they become wards of the city and eyesores. So I'm delighted that Monument is continuing to have an interest in our city.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for your comments. Any others, questions? I think we get to hear from Susan next.
Slide. Frozen. Okay. Mr. Britton, so this site is located at 1442 East Ocean View. It's on the north side of Ocean View between Sturgis Street and Willow Terrace. There is currently a single family home on the site now. Next slide. So what the applicant is proposing to do is he wants to add a second dwelling unit. So it will be, in essence, a duplex. So he's got one single family home now. He's going to add essentially another single family home. That makes it a duplex. That use is permitted in the RC district. The minimum is 50 basically by 100, which is 5,000. He actually has more than that. He's got closer to a 200 foot lot in depth, so he's got more square footage than he needs. In the residential coastal district, each type of use has their own set of alternative development form standards. For a duplex, one of those form standards says you can have a garage facing Ocean View Avenue. However, if you do, it's got to be 40 feet back. This applicant is not able to do that, and I'll show you his site in a minute. But the district also allows you to get a waiver from these alternative development and form standards through a conditional use permit. So that is why he is here. The garage he is proposing does face Ocean View Avenue. It's only 20 feet back. So by getting a conditional use permit, that would waive that requirement. Next slide. So over on the left, you can see his site plan. It's kind of small, but so that would be the new proposed dwelling. He's got two parking spaces up front. Then he's got the structure. And you can see again, that front facade is a garage. So two spaces in front and then two spaces in the garage. He meets the requirement for the whole site there. On the graphic, it's the one to the left. You can see the garage and then the nice stone wall and a tree. So that structure will go away. That garage will go away and it will be elevated. He's actually proposing a three-story, so he's going to keep the garage on the first floor and then go two levels up, and there'll be a dwelling unit above the garage. He's going to push it back. There are some site constraints because he doesn't want to take down the wall and he doesn't want to get rid of that tree. So the option is to, put the home a little further back and enter it from the front. By pushing it back 40 feet, he does start to interfere with the existing home. This graphic or the picture also does show that in this area, there are right next door, there are many garages that do front fairly closely on Ocean View Avenue. I actually do have some more. He sent some more photos showing other garages that front onto Ocean View Avenue in that area. I can add them, but I thought this was a pretty good graphic because it's the one right next door. Any questions on that one?
Commissioners?
I have a question. When you talk about elevating it, because you're stacking living on top of this, correct?
Correct.
Talk about elevating it is one entering under the structure, and that is closed, or is it open?
No, it's closed. It'll be a garage. And then he does also have, you can't really see it from this graphic, but there is actually also a carport on the left side of the structure. And one thing I do want to mention too, one of the things, he has given us elevations. However, this also falls in the RC, which also requires him to meet the coastal pattern book. There's a little bit of a conflict in what the zoning requires versus what that requires. So we're trying to work with him to make sure that his elevations will comply with the coastal pattern book. We may have to kick this one till February. He just emailed me a couple more questions today. So once we get that resolved, you'll also see some elevations.
Yeah, it appears that there needs to be more development on this before it would really meet what we would like to see in this circumstance, where you have the garage situated as it is.
Thanks, Ramona. Appreciate your comments. Anyone else? Okay, we'll move on to Serenity. Robert is presenting.
So 1353 East Ocean View Avenue. This one and the one next and the next one on the item on the list, 1357 East Ocean View Avenue. They are operated together. They are operated by the same applicant. So I'm going to go through them quickly. We'll together. They're on the south side of East Ocean View Avenue. They're between Beach View Street and Sturgis Street, which is to the east of Chesapeake Boulevard. They're currently apartments, and the proposal is to allow the existing apartment buildings to operate short-term rental units. Next slide. So in November 2019, the applicant applied for two conditional use permits for short-term rentals, and they were approved. So they're coming back now to get approved for another two-year period. During that two-year time, they haven't had any complaints or violations. Both of these apartment buildings are eight units. So all in all, it'll be 16 units across the two properties for a maximum of 32 people. And in the RC district, you need a short-term rental, you need a conditional use permit to operate a short-term rental with more than three units on site. Next slide, please. So this is a site we're gonna take a nice little walk around the building here. So you on the right side, you have the parking in front, and then you have the right facade of the building. Then on the left side of your screen, you have the main entranceways to the two apartments. So this is gonna be walking in between the sites. The sites have a shared drive access aisle. Next slide, please, Sherry. And then this is the rear of the property. You have more parking in the back again. You have the trash and recycling bins piled up. And then the leftmost image is how it is the rear view along the fence line there. Slide, please, Sherry. So the site improvements we're asking for the site, this applicant is not doing any exterior renovations to the building itself. So we didn't ask for elevations. But we are asking them to remove the parking space closest to East Ocean View Avenue. They're going to plant two rows of dwarf yupon holly, which are bushes, and then they're going to plant one live oak there. That section of total removed asphalt is going to be 6 feet wide by 30 feet long. And this is going to be the same on the other property. Sherry, can you go forward more? And then you can just go right to the site photos because this is all exactly the same. So on the left side, you can see there's some trees that are planted in between the unit to the left of it. You can see on the top there, that is the applicant's emergency sign. Call that number. She lives on the site, So that's why she posted her cell phone and name there. She lives in one of the apartment units. And then you see the other side of the other building there. Next slide, please, Sherry. Again, very similar story here. You have almost mirrored exactly the same on this side. You can see there, that's the middle drive in the middle top photo. You can see that's how it looks facing East Ocean View Avenue. You have another brick facade that's not going to be changing, and a parking area in the rear. And then you have what looks to be like a little bit of a broken fence and not a very nice looking rear side of the building. And then it's again the same renovations on this side, except it's going to be the front parking spot on the left side of the property if you're facing them. I wanted to take a second here to also, Sherry, you can go to the next slide, to go over, I don't know if you saw one of the other photos. This is a Sea Shack. This is a Tesseract property that came for us a conditional use permit application rent a few months ago, maybe a year ago. I just kind of wanted to look at it because I hadn't seen one of their properties. Of course, now my dog starts to bark. I hadn't seen one of their properties in person, and this was only two buildings down, so I figured it was worth checking out and giving you guys some context as to what these buildings kind of look like. So this is how you can see it from the front. You can see it's a white exterior. You have the dark shutters. Sherry, next slide, please. You have a metal sign anchored there for the issue of emergency, and Tesseract has their own management company. Hello, Susan, I do think they need to add the city Norfolk number on there too, am I right?
I don't know if it required that, but it would be nice.
Next slide, please. You can see they have three exterior lights, which is one thing I didn't, if you remember from the previous slides, I didn't see any exterior lighting in the front of the other property. Next slide, please, Sherry. And then you can see here, you can see the security cameras they have installed with the additional lighting. And then there's also a light in between these balconies here. So I remember, Ms. Austin, you were saying that you wanted to see, like we saw renderings of these properties last month in December, of a property similar to this in December, just to kind of see the comparison between what you get as an exterior in with these buildings that are being renovated versus some of the one that's being proposed. Please let me know if you have any questions.
So is this applicant using the same management company as Tesseract?
No, she manages them herself.
So they're related by proximity?
Yes.
Okay. And you mentioned that she lives on site. Is this going to be a hybrid model where some of the units are used as apartments and some are short-term rentals?
No, all of the units are going to be short-term rentals except for the one she is living in. But when we go through these applications, we've started having them written down as all units will be short-term rentals because even the one she lives in, because something could change over this two-year period, and it's easier just to have her have the ability to use that rather than going back and writing up a violation for her later.
Right. Thanks for the clarification. Questions, commissioners?
Rob, are you saying that she is going to upgrade her property to what you're presenting the Tesseract property being?
No, she's not planning to upgrade the exterior of the building except for the site improvement shown on the previous slide.
So she came through, and I can't remember, it's been 2 years. She came through and she did, the first time, she did make a significant number of improvements. I will say it's probably mostly landscaping to her site. So this time, you know, we are asking for even more improvements because now that we require less parking for short-term rentals in that area, we said, you can get rid of two more parking spaces and add landscaping along the front of the building or along the Ocean View Avenue.
But also, there is the conditions around the building aren't optimum, to say the least. One would expect there to be some remedy to that. And she may not be renovating the building But I, when we talk about adding value, how is value being added here the second time around?
Sherry, can you go back to the current site, the site in question, the photos of it? Thank you. Just so we're looking at the right side again. In terms of the improvements, we are getting the two rows of bushes that will provide some screening from East Ocean View Avenue, and we are getting two live oak trees, which does help meet the city's tree canopy coverage requirement. But I do think, Ms. Austin, you have a very valid point in saying that that is a very strong thing to be considered when we talk about approving short-term rentals.
Yeah, the condition of the building itself appears to be good, but what's going on in that picture to the far right?
The area behind the fence, or behind, between the building and the fence, it looks like a section of the fence was broken. In one of the photos I did not post on here, it does look like she's storing some material right behind the building in between the trash cans and the wall. I didn't want to include those during the meeting. I can definitely upload all of the site photos onto Dropbox if you guys would like that.
I mean, if she's storing stuff back there, Rob, that she shouldn't, we need to get her to clean it up.
I can pull up the photo. But to me, what I remember, it was a lawnmower, a ladder, maybe a couple pieces of siding, a piece of wood or two.
Sounds like a bunch of stuff that doesn't add value.
Yep.
Sounds like she needs a shed.
I remember a woman coming through. Is this the same person who did do, she worked hard to make the property acceptable and ready for short-term rentals, and she impressed us as not being a big company, but being who she was. And so if this is the same person, then we're looking at 2 years down the road, and the question is, well, what do we think that we actually got for that?
Right, and I think I remember that applicant, if it's the same one, who actually jumped the gun, but when we went out on our field trip, the improvements had already been made to the landscaping. Is it the same applicant, do you recall, Susan?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's right.
Okay. Questions, commissioners? Comments? Hearing none, can we move on to the next item? Robert, that looks like you also.
Yep, it's another short-term rental. So this is 6309 Tidewater Drive. It's on the west side of Tidewater Drive, just south of Muskie Avenue. It's right off the on-ramp there. It's a single family home, and the proposal is to allow it to operate as a short-term rental unit. Next slide, Jerry. So this is in SFT, a single family traditional, and all STRs in the SFT district require a conditional use permit. Next slide, please. Thank you. So you can see the site here. It's right off of that ramp on going to Tidewater Drive from Muskegee Avenue, I believe it is. And this site has a very irregular driveway that required special permits. You can see it's got a horseshoe shape. It's in the right-of-way a decent amount. Next slide, please, Sherry. I have pictures of it. So you can see the horseshoe shape there. I drove to this site. It is difficult to get in and out of that site. One of our concerns with this property is, given that proximity to the ramp and the high volume and speed of traffic on Tidewater Drive, it's really hard to see over that bridge. And we're concerned that transient residents, people who aren't familiar with pulling in and out of this area, it's gonna be a little unsafe for them. I mean, I tried to turn left out of there you can't make a left turn out of there. There's just too many cars coming from both directions and moving a little too fast. And into it also is it's tough turning around that driveway. It's not like a fluid, like there's not a lot of space. I was worried that I would drive off of the driveway and rip up that grass there.
Could everyone mute themselves while Robert's speaking? We're getting an echo. Thanks.
So we have some concerns with this site, especially from personal experience of being out there. If you commissioners get a chance to do so, this might be a good site worth visiting to see that proximity to that ramp and see how this site could potentially create some dangerous situations for guests. Next slide, please, Sherry. So the site improvements we're gonna be getting from this site, we're gonna require a foundation planting. So that's gonna be the planting shielding the crawl space. It's gonna be 3 foot wide, and our landscape architect, Stefan Zirk, provided species recommendations. He's gonna plant, it's not gonna be a maple tree. That's what he put on his site improvement. I forgot to change that. It's gonna be a loblolly pine or black gum tree that he's gonna plant in the backyard. And then we're also gonna ask him to replace his existing fence. You can see in the bottom picture there that he's kind of used a little concrete pad to drive over and extend his driveway into his backyard a little bit. There are actually, in another photo I took, there are wood planks underneath of the tire tread areas. So we're gonna ask him to replace that fence so we don't continue to have him use that area as another driveway and make sure we keep the landscaping there nice. It's also just, the fence is not in good shape. So we're gonna ask him to replace that as well. I think that's everything for this site. So commissioners, please let me know if you have any questions.
Would that horseshoe work better if that grassy area was included in it? If it allowed you more space to back up, to turn around, you know, whatever. I think I can visualize the bridge is behind. We've already passed over the bridge by the time you see the house and all of that, correct?
Correct.
So it's coming. So you could literally be blind kind of coming out of that horseshoe. How have they been able to deal with it up to this point?
I'm not entirely sure. I assume that there's some type of one way, an understood one way that you go in on the right, the driveway on the right side, and you go out the left. Because I don't think I would ever want to try to back out of that driveway if you had two vehicles pulled in to the horseshoe from each side.
It was only a single family home before, so clearly it was less of an issue. If you lived there, you kind of knew what you were dealing with. This circular driveway is brand new, and to be honest, we kind of broke the rules a little bit to let them have it because we realize it is probably very much necessary. And if you'll notice, where that dark line is, that's their property line. So it's cut off a little bit, but you can see that a good portion of that driveway is not on their property. We also don't allow people to pave their entire front yard, so we wouldn't allow them to pave any more than they already have.
Okay.
And the concrete pad extends off the right side of the well, I don't know why it's not included in the survey. It extends basically up to that 23-foot three mark on the right side there. I don't know why it's not on the survey, but it still makes it difficult. Like, I don't know if you could park a vehicle there and then still have people have access to get in and out of that horseshoe if someone is parked on that pad.
Yeah, I got that. How many parkings are needed there? Parking spaces? For how many cars can be accommodated or are asking to be accommodated?
We require them to have two parking spaces for this site. And I believe they can fit that on the section of the driveway that is in their yard. Does that answer your question, Ms. Austin?
Well, thinking of what, if it's safe or not, is this just a problem waiting to happen? If it's okay with this situation? you know, and then you're going to have a bigger problem as far as the city is concerned.
So again, Ms. Austin, we try not to give our, we're trying to just make sure you understand the facts, and we try not to give our recommendation, but I will just say, yes, we are very concerned and we agree with you.
Thank you. Other questions, comments? Robert, thank you very much. I think we're back to Susan.
Okay, Catch by the River, and this site is 4024 Granby Street. It was Veneziano's. It was an old Italian restaurant some time ago, closed for a while, kind of reopened as a restaurant for a while, was closed for a while. It is on the east side of Granby Street between 41st and 40th Street. Next slide. So just to give you some background, And I want to point out here, you know, when we talk about nightclubs and entertainment establishments, a lot of times we get the question, well, you know, why do we care about the managers? Why that should just be administrative approval. I think this is a really good case as to why we care about the managers. So in 2019, a conditional use permit was granted, and you guys probably remember this, to a certain applicant at 700 North Military Highway. It was called The Living Room. Same applicant who operated Culture, which again, they just handed in their conditional use permit. They're only operating as a restaurant now because of issues we had. Pretty quickly after that conditional use permit was granted, we had some different operators and managers take over. As you know, you can't do that because when a conditional use permit is granted, it is tied to a very specific set of managers and the business owner. And that information is provided by the applicants in their application. The applicants that took over are the same applicants that we're talking about for this location on Granby Street. Okay. They were notified at the 700 North Military Highway site that, hey, you guys are new managers. You don't have a valid conditional use permit. You need to come in. They failed to do so. Below is the list of the calls to the police while the applicants were operating the facility. I am not going to go over them. There's about 25 of them. They go on for, in total, probably 2 pages. You can see some of them: person with a weapon, assault in progress, person with a weapon. Next slide, Sherry. And they give the dates and the times. Again, this is straight from the police. Shots fired, EMS called, gunshot disturbance, disorderly disturbance, enforcement. Next slide. Again, more. Again, not going to read them all. Shots fired, but some pretty heavy-duty stuff. Fortunately, this is in the Military Circle Mall area. The city, the Economic Development Authority, purchased the site, and we terminated the lease. So we got the place shut down. It was a problem. So again, now that applicant proposed to come and operate a nightclub on Granby Street. He went to the Civic League. The council member was there. She expressed grave concern, as did the community, about the operation of a nightclub by this manager. He then revised his application. So the application before you is simply for a restaurant open until 2 with no entertainment. Next slide. So this is in the Riverview Pedestrian Commercial Overlay District. A restaurant operating until 2 o'clock would require a conditional use permit. If they closed at 11, they wouldn't require a conditional use permit. They are requesting those extended hours, so they are required to get a conditional use permit. Next slide. This is a copy of the floor plan. You can see, again, no entertainment. We are getting a couple improvements to the site. On 41st Street, there is a curb cut that goes to nowhere, so they'll close that off and curb it. And then the apron to the rear of the building is in pretty poor condition, so they'll replace that, and then their garbage cans are in the rear there. So we've asked that they not enclose them, but to at least hide them with a wood fence. And I think there's one more slide. Oh, it's not in here. Wanted to go through the capacity. So the capacity is 212. And again, the hours of operation are until 2 o'clock. Any questions on this one?
Susan, I just want to be clear. That list of 30-odd violations or calls for service, I should say, at the military location, the applicant who was running things then at that location is now applying here?
Correct. And we know that because, you know, we knew who the managers were supposed to be at the other location. And so when we were having problems and the police went in, they had the conditional use permit and they said, well, wait a minute, you're not who is supposed to be operating this. You're different people. You need to go see Susan Pollock, which they did. And at the time I explained to them, they needed a new conditional use permit and that didn't happen.
There doesn't appear to be any reason for us to believe that because it's becoming a restaurant, it's going to be any different than what it has been. It appears this manager is literally bringing a crowd along with him or her or whoever. And it doesn't matter what it is. There's just a crowd that is following this person that creates these circumstances. And can we trust that it won't be the same?
And so, again, we don't like to talk about what our recommendation is. But, you know, as George has kind of talked about, as we've talked about, what we really are preferring to see with folks is come in, get a restaurant zoning certificate, show us you know how to operate. So that would mean with him closing until, you know, closing at 11. And then once you've shown you can do it, come back. The other thing I failed to point out, and I really do need to, the other issue is parking. So, yes, because of the way we've written our parking requirements and we're trying to allow the reuse of older buildings, this is actually a contributing structure in a historic district, so we'd like it to see it reused. So we've really kind of tweaked our parking, and technically, without any parking, he meets the requirement because he has to have so many spaces in the PCO. It's one space per 200 square feet of the eating area. We vest him for as if it were retail, which is one per 300, but that's for the whole place. In essence, he's required to have 18. He's vested for 18. Technically, he doesn't have to have any parking. Now, he has signed a 5-year lease with a site directly to the south. It directly abuts the site to the south. That gives him 7 parking spaces. That's great. He also proposes to do valet parking. I asked him, where are you gonna valet park? He's working with the bank across the street. But we know where people are gonna park. They're gonna park on 40th Street, they're gonna park on 41st Street. There's residential directly behind this. They're gonna park there.
When you see that many and the nature of those police calls and what they find, they're just, I would read it as something else going on and not just what it is supposed to be. That would be my response to, I'm suspicious, in other words. And it doesn't make me confident that anything is going to be any different.
I think your suspicion is well placed. I'm a little more than suspicious. I would concur with you. I think he's bringing his crowd with him. And this is in the Riverview area, is it not, Susan? And the old
yes, and the neighborhood is not supporting this.
Okay, thank you.
Well, that's good to know. And I look forward to hearing from the applicant directly so that he can address what I feel are our building concerns. Do we have any questions, Amanda?
Yeah, Susan, I'm not understanding when they were told that when management changes, those are our policies, our rules, why they just didn't do it and how they were able to still operate, not following protocol.
So I think pretty quickly after that went down, we knew that we had purchased the site. We were putting some pressure on our development department to close them down because of these issues. And okay. Eventually that did happen, so...
Okay. What was that time frame, though? I mean, just ballpark it. Just curious.
Yeah.
I mean, are we talking like a few weeks, a few months?
No, no. It was months.
It was okay. Thank you.
And Susan, did I understand the city had to acquire the site?
Well, no, it was part of the, you know, we're acquiring all of the military circle area for that new development. So,
the EDA bought all of the military circle property from the company that was in default. And so the EDA did work with the city staff who had identified the problem. They are their own legal entity. They have their own legal counsel. I believe there was court action taken where they had to file in court to enforce the provisions of the lease that prohibit illegal behavior. And so, unfortunately, as with a lot of legal proceedings, it did take a little bit of time, but it did not take any more time than is customary with legal action during COVID. I think all this happened during the end of 2020, maybe?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Yeah, and in addition, in talking to Mr. Washington, they were quite a few months, perhaps even more than a year, in arrears on paying the rent. So the issue really wasn't necessarily bad behavior as much as it was the failure to meet the financial obligations that they had.
Very good. Thank you for all the information. Any other questions or comments? Okay, moving on to item number 10. Joy, you're up.
Yes, sir, thank you. So I believe the restaurant's name is Sabor Carbino, but I probably am butchering that, so I apologize. It is located on the juncture of Avenue J and Sewell's Point Road. And what they are asking for is to be able to operate the existing restaurant, but they want to add live entertainment and have extended hours. Next slide, please. So in 2017, the site, the applicant was able to obtain a conditional use permit for an eating and drinking establishment. The applicant proposes to add outdoor dining, so they want to expand their occupancy and they want to include entertainment, but this does not include a dance floor or a DJ and increase the hours of operation. Next slide, please. So here we see the subject property. Their restaurant is the end bay on your right there. Next slide, please. Here we see a comparison of the floor plan that was approved in 2017. And here we see the floor plan that they're proposing today. Next slide, please. Here we see a comparison of what they are currently approved for. They're approved to be open till 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday and 6 p.m. on Sunday. And then they want to extend those hours to 2. Right now, total capacity is at 35. They are requesting to be able to expand that to 103. They have no live entertainment at this time. They would like to include karaoke, live band, comedian, and poetry reading. But again, this does not include live DJ or a dance floor. Let me see. Next slide, please. And here we see a snapshot of the neighborhood. It is a very heavily commercial neighborhood. Sherry, at this point, can we scroll back to the picture of the site, image of the site? So it's possible, actually, I think very likely that this will not go forward. We will not be hearing this at the public hearing for January, simply because as part of their original 2017 conditional use permit conditions, required conditions, that they were supposed to have some trees planted along Sewell Point Road, where you see those short stubby shrubs. And Sherry, if you could just kind of scroll your mouse over where those short stubby, there. There's supposed to be at least 3 trees there. As you can see, there are no trees there. And so we've given given the applicant to the end of the week to rectify that. I have not heard back from the applicant, which leads me to believe that they have not done it yet, and nor will they be able to do it by Friday. So this may be delayed for a while. That concludes my preliminary report for
Joy, just a curiosity, where's the outdoor dining going to go?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. It's actually underneath the awning. Evidently, it's 10 feet wide, and then it spans the length of their business bay. Sherry, can you flip down to where the 2022 site plan is?
Okay.
Thank you. And then Sherry, if you could scroll your arrow just in front of the building.
That's the bottom of that, on the bottom,
yeah,
on the right.
Yeah, bottom.
Where
right.
It says dining, right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that's going to be blocking the sidewalk.
No. It's going to be blocking. There's a concrete paved area in front of the building. If you can see, there are two entry points into the restaurant itself. There are no seats representative in front of those two. I wish I could point to you, Sherry. I don't know if you can see
well,
where
I
there's
see,
a...
It's going to be the concrete pad. I call it a sidewalk,
yeah.
Right outside.
Okay. Yeah, then it'll block the building's sidewalk. Yes.
So if anyone's coming, I guess, from the south, they won't be able to access that sidewalk there because of the outdoor dining.
Well, they will have to go through the parking lot to access any other buildings, I guess. They will have to maneuver around I believe they have a little pick. Actually, the outdoor dining is already set up. I can get pictures for next time so you can kind of see what it looks like. Anyone who wants to enter the building has to, there's two breaks in the, it's sort of a fence line that make up the outdoor dining and that you can access into their space.
And I do hate to say this because I think we're going to be using this as an excuse for years to come, but you know, the only increase in their capacity is for this outdoor dining, and it I'm sure most likely is because of COVID, and they just need that outdoor space.
Sure.
I think this is probably the most reasonable place to put it.
Yeah. Sure.
I've been trying to look and see how they, because on first glance, because the seating is so light, you wonder, are people going to be standing? You know, where are they sitting and eating? But you can see, it's very faint, but you can see seating that's happening where it says dining.
Yes.
946 square feet, occupancy 49 seated plus two servers. It's still confusing how you get up to that 135 there.
Well, as you can see, there's also significant changes to their floor plan as well.
I'm looking to 2022.
Expanded their bay. Yeah, I think they expanded their bay or intend to expand their bay. I don't think so, Joy.
Go to your chart that shows how they're getting to that number.
Sure.
Gary, if you could go to that. Is the chart in there? Yeah, here we go. Yeah, they're only adding an additional 32 to 49 seats inside. It's really all outside that they're adding.
Outside seats, all right.
Okay, Joy, is that everything on this one?
That is, yes.
Commissioners, any other questions, comments?
No.
I'm sorry, did I hear? Okay, let's move on to item 11, the Up Center. Susan?
Okay, so
most of you are probably familiar with the site, or it was Interstate Bingo. It's in the Military Crossing Shopping Center, south side of East Virginia Beach Boulevard. Ollie's is in there, Origami was in there, a lot of other retail is in there. They are, the current applicant is operating the bingo hall there right now. Next slide. So in 2009, the site was granted, at the time it was a special exception, and we called it a commercial recreation center, but that was to allow the bingo. That is not one of those CUPs that is tied to a manager or operators. So this applicant was allowed to go in and use that special exception to operate the bingo hall. Similar to the prior applicant, they also did a banquet hall. Now, the banquet hall CUP, or at the time special exception, does go with the specific owner, operator, managers. So the current applicant was required to come in for a new conditional use permit for the banquet hall. So with the banquet hall, you kind of need the conditional use permit for the banquet hall, for live entertainment, and for alcoholic beverages on premise. Next slide. So a little bit more limited than the banquet hall when Interstate Bingo was doing it. A little bit earlier hours, 9 to midnight, 7 days a week. And it's the same for, actually, and the alcohol starts a little bit later, starts 11. Now, the capacity is more. I would tell you that's the space for the banquet hall is 22,000 square feet. It's huge. And they worked with their architect. They truly do have the space and the number of restrooms to put that number in there. And obviously for a banquet hall, you might have a wedding. So they are proposing live bands, a disc jockey, and a comedian. I will tell you, they have met with two civic leagues. They tried to meet with three, but the other one said they really weren't interested. They also hosted their own community meeting. They also invited the Lake Taylor Civic League onto the site. And you guys all know Charla. You hear from her often. She sent me photos. She was so impressed with this operation. It's spotless. It's neat. And they do a great job running the bingo hall. Don't know if I have anything more to say on this. Obviously, they've got sufficient parking. It's in a quite a large shopping center.
Thank you, Susan. Commissioners, any questions or comments? Okay, let's move to item 12, California Burrito. Joy, you're up again.
Yes, thank you. California Burrito, also known as The Back, is applying to be able to expand their capacity for their existing nightclub. They are located on Granby Street between West Freemason and College Place in downtown Norfolk. Next slide, please. In 2017, they were issued a special exception, now known as a conditional use permit, granted to operate the site as what we call a nightclub. If this current application is denied, they do have the right to continue operating as a nightclub with a maximum occupancy of 49. They are asking to be able to increase to 99. And then they also are going to change their floor plan a little bit. So for the past few, for quite some time now, they have had some issues of being able to keep their occupancy to, they've overloaded their occupancy on several occasions. But staff has worked with them. And in the past 6 months, they have proven themselves to be good actors. They also had a few building code violations, which also delayed their application, which they were also able to clear up. Next slide, please. So, as I said, just in the past 6 months, they were able to prove themselves that they could keep their occupancy at 49 or below. Sorry, one more thing. They are requesting the hours of 12 midnight, Sunday through Thursday, retaining the 2 a.m. closing on Friday and Saturday. Next slide, please. Here we see an image of the restaurant / nightclub. Next slide, please. The 2017 floor plan and then the 2022 floor plan. So there's not a whole lot of difference. My understanding is, as we've been told by the applicant's architect, that they could have had 99 all along. However, due to, I guess, bad advice from previous architect, they were told they could only have 49. Next slide, please. And here we see it is in the downtown Granby Street area. And that concludes my summary staff report for California Burrito, also known as the BAC.
Thank you, Joy. Commissioners, any questions about this application?
Could we go back to the elevation that she shows?
The floor plan, sure.
Floor plans, I should say more accurate.
That's okay.
Is it flip? Because I asked that on the right-hand side, it looks like what is on the right-hand side, what is on the right, looks like it's on the left, on the left-hand side, or am I just not seeing what it is?
Yeah, it's a little confusing. So if you look at the 2017 version, you can see a shaded portion of the floor plan that is not part of the applicant's restaurant, nightclub. That is another facility. So that is not included in what we're considering, in our scope of what we're considering. And then if you kind of look over on the 2022, it's not shaded, but it's just white out. But it's still the same L shape. It's a very narrow, long restaurant. And then the back portion, that's, I don't know if Sherry, if you can roll your, there you go, thank you. Your mouse in the back portion, that's primarily where most of the nightclub activity.
It's really confusing because you have stairways that do not show up one to the other. It looks like it's a completely different floor plan.
All I can tell you is that they were generated by two different architects. You're right, there is a stairwell. It does lead up to not necessarily a second floor, but as I understand it, more of a loft that overlooks the dance floor.
It looks like two different floor plans. It doesn't look like it's for the similar spaces. Because it's an old building, you can't change the retaining and all of that easily there. There's got to be elements that remain the same, and it's different here than the other one. So it is really confusing.
We can doctor the slides a little bit so it's more comparable. And I mean cut and expand a little bit so you're comparing apples to apples.
Concerned for the meeting when we know that it does look like what it really should be, because there doesn't. And sometimes to pick up on that, and it's,
And I think part of it, Ramona, is that he operates that other restaurant, which is why they put it all on one floor plan. So yeah, we can fix that.
Maybe outlining the restaurant and then outlining the portion that's used as the back might be the best way to do that.
I can do that, yes.
Great. Were there any other comments or questions on this application? Hearing none, we're ready to move further down the agenda, but before we do, we obviously have a very full agenda at the next public hearing. So please review the staff reports before we have our next work session so that we can make efficient use of the public hearing preview. I want everybody to have every opportunity to make every comment or ask every question, but we're not going to be able to spend a lot of time on these individual applications and get through the preview before the public hearing if we're not all prepared. So I appreciate your cooperation with that. Moving on, I think the next agenda item is the director's comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. Unfortunately, I got a long list, so I'll try to get through them pretty quickly. With Matt's presentation of the draft annual report, one of the things that I hope you all took away from it is just how important and relevant the Planning Commission is to what happens to these applications. You've got, north of 90% over a decade of agreement between the Planning Commission and City Council on how to deal with things, which is, I think something that is indicative of how much council relies on y'all to do most of the heavy lifting on these applications. So I hope you all take that away. And that's sort of a foundation for some of the other comments I'm going to make. One of which is that make sure that all of you recognize that the Planning Commission always has the option to continue an item. Just as you did last month with the two short-term rentals out in Ocean View, if you are not ready, if there are questions, if you'd like to consider a different way of doing something, then you always have the opportunity to continue an item. You always have the opportunity to continue an item and ask the applicant to go back and talk to their neighbors, as you did last month. So please keep that in mind as we go forward, we work hard to bring you a recommendation at your meetings, but that doesn't mean you have to act on it if you are not comfortable with what has been with what you see, what you have before you. So I point that out and make sure that keep that in the back of your mind as we progress through the year. The council actions, council on Tuesday night approved all of the conditional use permits that came out of your December meeting, with the exception of J Training Center, and because that one had a negative vote, by protocol that does not go on the consent agenda, it goes on the regular agenda of the following meeting, and so that's that. And I was able to provide a briefing of that to council. Dr. Austin, you had brought up the issue last month of your concern on that particular application about the lack of a really substantial and well thought out business plan. We did refer to our economic development department, and the economic development folks referred it to their their on-call consultant that provides technical assistance to small businesses and entrepreneurs in the city. There's been a way to at least address your concerns and help the individual entrepreneur try to develop perhaps a stronger plan moving forward. So I just wanted to let you know that. Final changes that you're going to start seeing. As you recall, Matt Simons moved over to Resilience, and that meant that Tristan Barnes was promoted to the floodplain administrator role in the department, which left a vacancy for the CRS coordinator. That's now been filled by Alyssa Flatt. Some of you may have met Alyssa. She was manning the front desk for most of COVID. She's been the only one that has been consistently in our office suite to manage the phones and the mail and the little bit of document stuff that has to be done. So, but you'll begin to start seeing Alyssa at your meetings as she takes on her new role in the floodplain world. And then we've also just recently hired a young lady in the long-range planning section who is a product of Clemson. Mr. Newcomb was not on the interview panel, didn't have anything to say about that, but I'm sure he was thrilled to find out that another Clemson alum is coming to the city. Her name is Julie Martin, and she starts in a couple weeks. You will also be seeing a fair amount of her as Tom gets on. Lots of conversation today about short-term rentals. Short-term rentals have sort of become our nemesis, and one of these things that we just struggle with month in and month out. And I know you all do as well. So just want to forewarn you that we get to our February mid-month. One of the items that we will have on that agenda will be to talk with you all about some tweaks that we want to make to the ordinance, as well as a plan for enforcement that we have submitted as part of the FY23 budget. So you have some sort of sense as to where we're heading and what we're doing. I really do appreciate the comment earlier today that the current process is actually working pretty well. And what we know is that people have gone through the process, either the by right registration or the CUP, are not bad actors. It's the ones who refuse to go through that process that we're having to deal with. So I appreciate that comment and that recognition. But we are trying to improve our enforcement capacity in both short-term and long-term. So, nightclub, late-night entertainment establishment. So the last thing I want to bring up, I'm just going to throw this out as an idea. Hopefully my staff won't start screaming at me. They may. So they're right. But, you know, we're talking about the commissary kitchen application. And this is one of those areas where, you know, we sort of rely on the commission to help us with it sometimes. So the commissary kitchen, it's that the issue is the way conditions were written in conditional rezone a number of years ago. And so the concern could be, and I admit I have this concern, is that if we have the opportunity to convert a conditional zoning to a base zoning district, then perhaps we ought to, because otherwise the conditions that we set today may well trip us up in the future. If there is a base zoning that provides the same level of protection as the conditional zoning. So the conditional zoning is really needed when you have to, and I think the best example perhaps is the facility up in Ocean View, where it's a very specific list of conditions, and it was agreed to by applicant, communities, what have you. And in that case, it might make some sense, except that, you know, the next person coming along, the next entrepreneur, you know, these 2 a.m. entrepreneurs we have in the city these days, they have a new business idea about every third nanosecond. And it may be something we didn't contemplate. And if do we have to go back through a rezoning on something that could have been a base zoning district where it would have allowed the zoning administrator to say, yeah, that's similar enough to something else that's over. So I offer that out as a, you know, something to think about. The case of the commissary kitchen, probably a rezoning to a straight, unconditioned neighborhood commercial, CN, would provide the neighborhood with just as much protection as the conditions that have been worked out with the neighborhood. And sometimes these are the kinds of conversations that we as a staff and planning commission need to have with each other as to whether or not we always pick the optimal solution. So I'm a fan of conditional zoning. It provides real protections. I'm not a fan of conditional zoning. It just simply is there for the sake of being. And so that's just something that we talk about going forward. With that, Mr. Chairman, congratulations, sir. Congratulations, Ms. Sutter. If you have questions, I'm here to answer them.
Thank you, George. Do we have any questions for George?
George, are those folks you hired, are any of them minorities?
I wish I could say that they were. In both cases, we actually made a real effort to go to the Hampton University in Norfolk State, try to recruit directly, and we just it's very difficult because for whatever reason, planning profession does not attract a lot of minority interest, which is a real shame because there's a whole lot wrong with the planning profession that could be fixed if more minorities were to get involved and be able to surface some of the issues that are out there. But, we were unable to pull it off those two. We'll continue to do so for every application, for every opportunity we have going forward. We did make an offer. I should know the one long-range planning. We did make an offer to a minority candidate, but he turned us down because there's no way we could put a salary requirement. So that's where we are. I wish I had better news.
Well, I don't know that that's bad news, George. It's certainly not good. But and I didn't ask the question to complain. I just think in the tone of society, you read everywhere now about how planning has been not the most favorite disciplines when it comes to minorities historically. I know we have a problem in our city. We can't keep them because other folks pay more and what have you. I would just urge you, please, in any way, shape, or form, do whatever you can to continue to try to comb the waterfront, if you will, to try to find suitable minority candidates. And I'm sitting as, you know, who you talk to, 45% to 55% minority.
Yeah, I got to tell you, we had a super minority candidate working for us until COVID came along. And then she's ultimately been snapped up by Aaliyah Slappy and working for the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Office. So, which is, it's good that she's working for the city.
Right.
We're still working the plan.
Yeah, unfortunately, in an economy with 10 million job vacancies, the people looking for jobs get to do the picking, and not always us.
Yeah. Well, maybe some other city got a great minority candidate. We'll just have to keep banging away at the drum to see if we can't be successful.
Yes, sir, I agree completely.
Oh, you're absolutely right. You know, our diversity should be our strength. We need to work harder. Any other comments from commissioners?
Yes, and I don't mean to dominate this, but earlier during our session today, Ms. Pollitt told us to beware. She's about to get cranky. I tell you, that wasn't crankiness at all, Susan. That was good advice. Fact of the matter is, with the advent of the pandemic, we can't do our field trips like we want to. And I'm the one advocating for this because of the work that I do. I put in a lot of windshield time anyway. So I'm out and about in the ocean views and the Gents and all those other little places. But where possible, commissions, as your schedule allows, please look at some of these applications that got you scratching your head. Ride by, look at them, get a sense for what the staff is telling you. I don't know that you solve a lot of problems that way, but a lot of the obvious things can be eliminated. But just a drive-by, familiarizing yourself with the site. And I found that to be very, very helpful. But admittedly, I'm already out there. And I know some of you had to make special trips for that. But if I'm on West Ocean View Avenue and I'm looking for a comparable in Ocean View and I'm on that East Ocean View, well, that's right around the corner from this project we're talking about. It does wonders for me. And I'm sure it'll help you as well as your schedule will permit. But thank you for your crankiness, Susan. I think that was good advice.
Absolutely.
And Mr. Fraley, Mr. Chairman, if I can follow up on that, you know, anytime you're out and you see something and you have a question, please do not hesitate to either pick up the phone and call us or email us or text us and ask the question or, you know, make the point that you need to, you feel needs to be made or points something out to us that you want to. Because, you know, we are all in this together. It's an important part of your job as a planning commissioner is to help us do our job even better.
Great point, George. There's no need to wait till these work sessions to communicate with staff. The more prepared we are, the better and more deserving the applications are. They deserve that, and so does staff. Anyone other than Earl have any comments?
Yeah, George, I have a question for you real quick. Well, we talked earlier about outdoor dining in one of the applications. Where are we with, you know, I know we've turned our blind eye with the COVID. Where are we with these outdoor dinings? Is that going to, you guys are going to start hammering down on them soon? Or are we working with the businesses to figure out how they can apply to keep their outdoor dining? I would imagine a lot of them are going to want to keep it. I think it's been a good thing for the city. So I'm just curious where we are on that.
Yeah. Well, I think I'm going to pass the baton to Mrs. Shea on that because she's been working with the consultant team that the city has brought on board. But we're thinking about we're not thinking just of outdoor dining. We're thinking of outdoor spaces and outdoor activation. So it's not just dining. It's the entire milieu of you know outdoor use of outdoor spaces. So. Paula, if you could jump in, please.
Absolutely, yes. The city has hired Yard and Company through our urban design contract with WPA, and they are on a fast track to come up with a concept for us about outdoor spaces and activating outdoor spaces and what I like to refer to as chapter one of that, because we're going to, you know, roll it out as fast as we can. Is revisiting the what we call streeteries, the on-street dining that cropped up during COVID that basically saved businesses. You know, that helped save businesses, and we're trying to transition that to a program that can be managed and be up to standards, and where we start charging fees because it's free right now to be out there. We did everything we could to help businesses, so. We allow those to stay through the end of 2022. That is how we permitted them in the first place. And we are coming up with a set of very specific pre-approved designs that if and over-the-counter approvals come up with a fee system for those. So they are to brief City Council by the end of this month. So we are on a very fast track. And then we will be coming through ARB and the Planning Commission for review because we will want a packet of what we call pre-approved designs. So you guys will be briefed as we move this process through. And then the idea is then we're going to move on to talk about outdoor dining on the sidewalk and come up with very specific standards for that. I know we have some design guidelines, but the questions always come up at ARB and Planning Commission as to, can we have a roof? Can it have a knee wall? Can it have this? And we want to be very, very deliberate and understand what we're getting into with that. And then the third phase is kind of taking a look at other activities, whether it's outdoor retail opportunities, things like that. But we're only dealing with dining up front.
How about outdoor dining in parking lots? Are you looking at that as well?
Yes, that we want to get some guidance on that. That doesn't have the same urgency as trying to deal with it in the right of ways on the street and on the sidewalks. But yes, that is part of the work program too.
Yes. I just hope whatever we do, we can give the businesses, it may be as much as a year or 6 months, at least 6 months advance notice, as you got to go through this hoop before we start, you know, cracking down on you to take down your outdoor dining. I mean, I really think, and I've gone to quite a few of them, it's been actually a pleasant addition to the city in a lot of circumstances, and a lot of companies, and WPA helped out under the mayor's direction, setting up a lot of these, you know, outdoor facilities. So I'd like to see them stay, but I'm afraid one day it's going to come down to, all right, we're done with COVID, you got to take them up. And they're not figure out how to apply and make it permanent if it makes sense in that circumstance.
Yeah, fortunately, the thinking at the time is, and this is constantly evolving and is going to be presented to council again at the end of the month, not with everything ironed out, but is that, again, they're permitted through the end of 2022. We made that promise up front. In fact, George made the call. Nobody was willing to make the call, and George went, you know what? December 31st, 2022, tell them that date. So whatever's going to happen is going to be adopted, the fee schedule and everything, as part of the budget cycle, so it would be for July 1. But the thinking is that it really wouldn't be implemented till the end of 2022, because we have that on the books, that you're good till the end of 2022. So we have time to get it right and roll it out and communicate it.
Well, Mr. Chair, I did have one other thing, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
I wanted to, I said at the beginning, you know, with Earl took a very selfless act by stepping down as the chair over the next year, and I think it's going to bring a lot of good to the Planning Commission again, because he's going to have the honor of voting first, and or I hope, Earl, that we hear you speak a lot before you vote, you know, to help the Planning Commission understand what your viewpoint is. You know, I've always been amazed, and I said this briefly, but, you know, I've always been amazed when, you know, during public hearings or discussing any item, you know, we could be talking about downtown, Military Circle, West End, Young Terrace, Ocean View. You always were connected. You always are connected, not where are, connected with the neighborhoods and those who are neighborhoods. And even bigger than that, when we talk about, you know, items and locations, the corner of, you know, Ward's Corner or the corner of Hampton Boulevard and 38th Street, you pick it. You know, you always knew there was a mini mart nearby or this nearby, and what's the impact on that? And you know, the leadership, at least for me, that you've had over the last 10 years, you know, has been incredible. Just been such a valuable asset to it. So I just wanted to say thank you for all your service on that. And thank you for staying one more year in a role that's going to allow you to really mentor us. More so than you can as a chair, because as a chair, you know, you vote last, you speak last. So, you know, your time to get your thoughts in is too late, because everyone else has their thoughts in. So it's going to be an important role for you to mentor us over the next year. So I appreciate you stepping down, doing that selfless act, and I appreciate your tutelage and leadership over the last 10 years.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Very kind of you. You know, my motivation was simple motivation, folks. There are six other more than capable people. And I don't see myself as being chair for life. I've been very, very grateful with you folks and your predecessors. I thank you for that opportunity. I will continue to. I love this stuff, okay? But just because you do, you shouldn't be greedy about it. It's about sharing. The more we know collectively, the better we are collectively. My experience and expertise can help move us forward, get us, you know, I read that report every year with such pride, because we collectively, 95%+ of our recommendations are upheld at the next level. I mean, how much better than, it can't get much better than that. And we are limited into what we have to consider each application upon, the land use, the zoning ordinance, the comprehensive plan. And the council has a ubiquitous look at everything. And so we give them our best guess, and they add whatever they have to add to it or take away from it. But we do a credible job. And I just want other people to see that we got outstanding people here besides the guy who happens to be the chair. You folks, if I've been successful, it's because of you folks. It's because of staff. And I hope we just continue to do so. But I don't know if I have too many opinions, Matt. But what I do have, I'll try to share. No question about that.
Well, thanks again, Earl. I appreciate it.
Thanks to you, my friend. Thanks to you indeed for your service.
Excellent. Yes.
Earl, I want to say you have a real gift at handling difficult situations and making them positive. And I've learned a great deal watching you do a very adroit two-step.
But see, when you're dealing with intelligent people, they just need to understand that there are clearly two sides to every story. But that doesn't always happen with planning. Sometimes there are four sides. And we got to find a way to get around that. But we just got to crack staff, Dr. Austin. I mean, George and Susan and Adam and all the folks that make presentations to us, they got the information. We just got to make sure we asked all the right questions and ask them also to provide us with what we think we need to make a considered recommendation. I just think, this is a situation where we are appointed. This is not a circumstance where we and then we select the chairman from amongst ourselves. And by the grace of the Almighty, I've been forcing us to have that for a good while. I just want others to experience that. It's a great position to be in. We're all respected around the city, but all of us have leadership qualities. We wouldn't be sitting here if that were the case. We're not the case. So I just think that we get stronger the more we all have an opportunity to let our skills demonstrate themselves. And heck, I didn't give it much thought until right around the holidays. And I said, it's probably time for an opportunity for other people who are giving up their time, just like myself, to have an opportunity to be in a leadership capacity with the Planning Commission. So I'm delighted to still be with you guys. Anything I can share, I will. And I look forward to our meetings. I was hoping that 22 would mean that we get back together in person. Maybe if we're lucky sometime in the latter half of this year, we'll get to do that. I do miss the field trips. I do miss leaning over, talking to George, or him talking to me. And I think that goes a long way towards helping us come up with the recommendations that we do. But I thank you all for all your support.
Thank you, Earl. You're very generous and, as always, setting an excellent example for all the commissioners. Anyone else like to add anything? Great. I appreciate your support today and going forward, and I look forward to our next meeting. Everybody take care. We are adjourned.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.